Welcome to Blenheim Equisports TV for this Friday, April 9th, 2021. I'm David Portner, and I'm broadcasting from the virtual studio at the beautiful Rancho Mission Viejo Riding Park in San Juan Capistrano. Today's feature class is the $15,000 USHJA International Hunter Derby honoring Arthur Hawkins. And today's class is going to be featured on the grass on the Oaks International Grand Prix field. Today, we're going to be joined by color commentators Sue Lightner and Diane Carney, both large yard judges, and we're sure they're going to share with you some tremendous insight into the class. Now, in a minute, we're going to go to an interview that I had with one of today's judges, Sue Ash. And now it's my distinct pleasure to interview one of the judges for tomorrow's class, Sue Ash, who's recently been inducted into the Show Hunter Hall of Fame. Sue, come on in here and join us. Hi, Sue, and welcome to the program.
Thank you, David. It's an honor and a thrill to be here.
So I understand you're pretty excited to be on the grass tomorrow.
I love this grass field. I've judged derbies here before. It is awesome, and the horses all give their all for it.
So what will you be looking for in the horses during tomorrow's class?
Well, basically, we want to see a good jumper, a brilliant jumper, a good mover. And on the grass, the footing is so beautiful that usually you do have great jumpers.
And in your opinion, what tends to separate that first place and second place?
I'd say brilliance. We're lucky to have Kerry Coker as a course designer. He does a beautiful job. And he is as much for the horses to show their brilliance as we are to judge them from their brilliance.
Tell us more about what makes a great hunter.
What makes a great hunter is, first of all, their movement. Well, that's really not the first. The first is the jump. But then they have to be a very good mover. They have to have a good approach with the ears, not a sour one, which on this beautiful grass field, if there's a sour one, I'll be surprised, because they enjoy it as much as we enjoy watching them go.
Now, we appreciate your time, and we're looking forward to tomorrow's class.
So am I. Thank you so much. I appreciate you very much, and Blenheim, all of them.
On behalf of Blenheim, we're thrilled you're here. Thank you, Sue.
Thanks.
Thank you, Sue. And now, back to the studio. Welcome back to the studio. And now, I'd like to share with you an interview we had yesterday with Nick Hannes. We caught up with Nick yesterday afternoon to talk to him about today's Derby. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Nick Hannes. Nick, come on in here and join us. Hi, Nick, and welcome to the program.
Thank you, David.
So you've had a tremendous winter. Can you share with us some of the highlights and horses?
Yeah, this year has been a very exciting year for us. We've been off to a good start, just coming off of a successful thermal circuit out in the desert. Some of my favorite highlights included winning a few of the Hunter Derbies, national and international derbies. We had a great Hunter Spectacular the last week, the WCHR $100,000 Spectacular, which I finished second, fifth, and seventh. I had three horses in the class, and they all finished in the top 10, so that was a very exciting night for us and for all my owners. A horse named HH Elmo, owned by Lindsay Maxwell, was second. Starburst, owned by Archie Cox and Nicole Lathrop, was fifth. And Rhesus was seventh, owned by West Coast Equine Partners. So all three of those horses had a really exciting circuit. A lot of exciting things to look forward to throughout this year. Another one of my personal favorite highlights of this year in Thermal, I was crowned the leading Hunter rider, which was a really exciting accolade to win, and very excited to be named the leading Hunter rider. So that was a really exciting finish to our circuit.
Great. So now tomorrow we're going to be riding on the grass. Tell us what your thoughts are going into tomorrow's Hunter Derby.
It's great to be here at the Blenheim facility. The sun is shining. The grass looks beautiful. The International Derby goes on the Grand Prix field tomorrow, which is a really fun ring to ride in. It always allows for the horses to gallop and jump beautifully. I'm sure the course will look great. So it's going to be an exciting day.
Nick, we really appreciate your time. Congratulations on all the success you've had so far. We're wishing you much more in 2021.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nick. And now, a word from our sponsors.
Horseflight is excellence in international shipping. We like to say when you fly with us, you fly first class.
Horseflight was started by professionals in this industry, so your horse is next to our horse, and that means they're getting the best care, the best attention, the best service possible during their travels.
I felt like I could give something back to the clients, and that's what we try to do. We give first class service. Give us a call. Call Horseflight, and we'll get your horse here.
Farm Vet is here to support you and your horse, both in and out of the show ring. From our highly trained staff to the best horse health product selection, we care about horses. Life out here can get pretty busy, so shop with Farm Vet in three convenient ways: by calling our sales team, shopping online, or stopping by one of our mobile locations. Everything you need is just a few steps away. From brushes and bandages to all of your pharmacy needs, Farm Vet has just what you are looking for. From all of us to you, welcome to Farm Vet. We are Horse Health.
Hi, I'm Ashley Bond, and my favorite Sinutra product is Sinchill. It is our go-to staple in the barn. Whether the horse be wild or nervous or just a little distracted, I just find that, you know, whether you use one tube, two tubes, three tubes, you know, you're able to kind of gauge based on what your horse is dealing with, you know, and it just helps pretty much any situation without taking the quality of the horse's jump and character away. So it is seriously, like, I could not live without Sinchill. Like, I tell everybody about Sinchill. It's like, have you heard of Sinchill? What's that? Oh, and then it's like, they can't get me to shut up about it. So I've never really been one to support products that I'm not fully vested in. And I would have to say Sinchill has become like the most exciting product that I have as part of the LVF team.
Good morning. Welcome to Blenheim Equisports and the USHJA International Hunter Derby on the grass today with 22 horses on the order. I'm Diane Carney. I'm sitting here with Sue Lightner, and we will be doing the commentary this morning. We'll be with you during a 22-horse class. We have 22 horses on the order. We look forward to a great day of sport of hunters on the grass here at Blenheim. And let me introduce to you Sue Lightner, who will be sitting here with me all day. Sue, how are you this morning?
I'm great, Diane. Fun to be here. It looks like a beautiful day and a beautiful course set out on what's normally the Grand Prix field, but today it's dedicated to the hunters.
Yeah, the sport of hunters. And we come from a vintage that understands riding in a ring of this size without so many boundaries. And these riders will have a great opportunity to talk about the riders' ability to connect their horses going forward to these questions that have been built by Carrie Coker, who was our course designer. And Sue, you've walked the course. We walked together, but give our listeners a little bit of an impression of what you took away from walking the course.
Well, I think Carrie has presented some really interesting fences. It's quite inviting. It's open to a lot of galloping. I would expect that when the riders come into the ring in the beginning, obviously they're going to take a nice long way around, I would imagine, just to give the horses an opportunity to get used to the field. I would anticipate as they come into the gate, there's a jump set down near the in gate. It's a big log. And I would guess that a lot of the riders are going to trot right by that because it's a bit of a different obstacle from the other things on the course.
Yeah, I agree. When I walked, I definitely fence six is the jump that Sue's talking about. And we'll have a chance to go around the course with you as we have a horse that goes on course. We're looking right here. The picture you're seeing is the same picture we're seeing. And this jump right in front of us is a little later in the course. It's jump four. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful day here at Blenheim, as it always is. And but the other fence that caught my eye was the swoop oxer, which we can see. I think our viewers can see a little to the left of the picture. What did you think about that jump when you walked up to it?
Well, I think it's a really interesting jump. Frankly, I think that the horses are going to find it more inviting than maybe some of the riders because it presents a little bit of an optical illusion. Notice too that it's an option fence, meaning that the high side on the left is going to garner an extra bonus point versus the lower side on the right. And which option the riders choose are going to depend a little bit on the level of their horses and also what they really feel their horses are going to be comfortable with and jump well.
Yeah, they might even have a plan of hoping to be able to get those high options. And then as the horse is riding around where they get started, they don't really feel them take a breath yet. They may make a strategic choice,
right,
to jump a little lower and make sure their round stays in the high 80s or 90s and give up that 1 point. Or they may be very bold and feel a horse with a little more experience is able to take that on visually early in the course. For me, that's an early test that we'll keep an eye on. We'll get around to talking about the rest of the course as we have a horse on course. Let's talk a little bit about this class's dedication. This class is dedicated to a great friend and a judge that raised many of us, and that's Arthur Hawkins.
Yes.
Known as Artie Hawkins. He's a friend to everyone. He was brought along through the early 50s and 60s and 70s. He rode with his dad at Shannon Stables. And an interesting part about Artie is he was part of the Parade magazine as a advertiser marketing guy. And he also had two photography shops. I didn't know this until I read the Phelps Media press release.
Wow.
He had two photography shops in New York. Those are just little sidebars. What we really know Artie mm-hmm. for, which is an interesting fact I did not know until I did my research, is the open numerical scoring system is Artie Hawkins. That
really?
Is the foundation of where it came from. And we can thank him for making that a very useful and user-friendly system of judging, especially with classes of 50 to 60 to 70 and more horses. So Artie Hawkins, great friend. This class is dedicated to Arthur Hawkins. We'll talk more about him as the class goes on. And then later today, there's quite an award coming. What's that award?
It's
Sue?
The Arthur Hawkins Award of Excellence. And it's given annually to an individual who has contributed to the industry of show hunters in a significant way during prior show years. This award was actually developed to honor the ongoing commitment and contribution of Artie Hawkins to the show hunter industry.
And who are some of the recipients prior to today that have received this award?
Well, it goes all the way back to 2008, and the first winner was Jenny Karazisis, who we will see on several mounts today. The 2009 winner was Archibald Cox, 2010 John Bragg, 2011 John French, 2012 Hope Glynn, 2013 Carlton Brooks, 14 was Peter Lombardo, 15, Nick Hannes, 16, Philip Sillis, 17 Laura Wasserman, 18 Coast Karazisis, and 19 Janie Andrews. So whoever today's recipient is going to join a nice roster of wonderful horse.
That's high praise and great esteem in that group. That's a great group of horsemen, and what a wonderful award, not only for Blenheim Equisports to be presenting in the name of Arthur Hawkins, but for the person that will receive it today, which will happen according to the production list that I heard. That award will be presented in between the first round and the handy round. So we'll keep you up to speed on the Arthur Hawkins Award as we get more information on that. You can see it's a little foggy here, but it's really quite beautiful down on the field. I just love coming to California. I'm out here judging all week, and I just love coming to Stephanie Wheeler and Alex Zulia and all the team at Equisports. It's just great to be here, and the classes are full. Sport is full on here in Mission Viejo.
Yeah, the Oaks facility is for sure one of the most beautiful in California. The footing's great. The horses seem to jump super on the grass here. So it sets the stage for a really nice event.
Oh, fantastic. And the whole inception of the Hunter Derby was about a class like this.
Exactly.
The whole heartbeat of the Hunter Derby comes from jumping in a field and galloping and getting out of the ring, if you will, even though this is, in quotation marks, the Grand Prix ring, but it's a big field.
And it's a really big field, and I think horses are encouraged to gallop. You know, they're not necessarily cantering and seeing a corner coming up. It looks pretty wide open, so it gives them the opportunity to feel pretty free-spirited and hopefully jump accordingly.
Well, horses jump out of a great gallop, and we'll be talking about a lot of the training techniques and some exercises that go along with bringing a great hunter, show hunter along. Sue has had so many, and I've had so many in my career. We'll talk a little bit about those memories. I can remember getting to know Sue. I think she had a chestnut horse with a white spot on its belly. What was his name?
His name was Malisco.
And I think he won a lot in front of me.
He did, in fact.
No wonder we got acquainted. But a beautiful, beautiful example of a show hunter. And that comes from understanding the training of a show hunter. And we're talking about setting a pace. We're talking about getting a rhythm. We're talking about style, the scope of the horse. We'll use the word bascule because we'll get a chance to watch how horses beautifully finish their jump using their arc. We'll talk about the straightness of the horse and how important it is in a big field like this to be connected leg, seat, and hand with your horses galloping around. To Sue's point of what she just mentioned earlier, you know, sometimes in the smaller rings, the boundaries of the ring do that contact for you.
Absolutely. The horses see it coming and they already anticipate which direction to turn.
And here we could see if the horses are not connected, if they don't feel like they're being, you know, ridden every stride in between the jumps, maybe a little left or right some moment or in a lead change that
sure
didn't exactly get connected back to front. Mm-hmm. So we'll watch for all of that. We hope we see very little of that, but it's anticipated with the different levels of riders that we'll get to talk about some different training exercises and what helps horses get confident jumping in big fields.
Yeah, this kind of galloping and jumping is a real test of the connection, I think, between horse and rider. And those who really know their horses well probably have a little bit of an advantage on a field like this.
Sure, a greener horse is definitely going to have his hand held a little bit more around and a little more advanced partnership. We'll see. We'll probably take a few more risks. But, you know, back in the day, to date us both, you know, automatic release was a part of how we rode.
Right.
I mean, there wasn't a crest release.
Right. Yeah.
There was a grab the mane release.
Right.
But there wasn't really a crest release as much as it was to follow the mouth of the horse. And, you know, your judging panels today, both Sue Ash and Brian Lenahan are on separate teams. They come from that era.
Mm-hmm.
They come from the automatic release. So seeing a rider with elastic arms, the independent hands and arms created through the balance of their position, will be an advantage in not only helping the horse be confident jumping, but keeping the style of the horse's jump over some of the wider fences and off of the bigger step.
Yes, and I think with this group of riders, I think whichever release they choose to use, I think you're going to see some good quality riding and some good following through by the riders, allowing the horses to have the freedom of their head and neck in the air. Some people think that the long gallop to the single oxer at times, that long crest release is a little bit of a, look at this, my horse can do it on his own. So there, sometimes that can be used a little bit to make an impression of the horse's freedom.
Yeah, and I would concur with that, because if somebody can gallop on a loose rein and not have a swap and the horse goes dead straight and can jerk its legs and give me a beautiful jump, I am more than happy to go into the 90s with it.
Right.
But if they lose their straightness, that would be a deterrent in that
yes.
moment.
Yeah.
The straightness would become first for me.
Yeah.
You?
Would agree. Yeah, I would agree. Absolutely.
Super.
I think it's interesting, though, sometimes, you know, riders, as they're going across the diagonal heading into the corner, there's a little bit of a subtlety where if you're too early to look into the turn, sometimes that will create a swap off the ground with
sure.
a horse.
So we're going to be talking about the horse's rhythm, style, and straightness, and we're going to have our first horse on course here any moment. I think the schedule says 8:05, and I think the camera is showing us that we have a horse standing at the end gate, and they are right on time. Fantastic.
And here we have our very first horse, number 980. This is Rolo. Augusta Iwasaki is in the saddle for Araya Nathu, Chris Iwasaki, the trainer. Augusta has a bit of a long relationship with this horse. She's had some really, really good placings over the last couple of years. In fact, she managed to be second in the rider list in 2020, second only to Kelly Farmer. So this is a good one to watch.
This is jump one. It's a nice inviting vertical. I would anticipate you might see riders come off either lead to that. The sun is coming out. This is the first option jump.
And she chooses the high one.
Now I'm noticing that she's changing her gear a little bit. She's stepping up because jump number three is the swoop oxer.
And once again, she chooses the high one. Notice how beautifully she rode right up to that. Horse held his lead, jumped it in really good form.
Jump number four is an imposing roll top. It'll hold the horse in the air a little bit, even though it's a vertical.
And the high option again, three for three so far.
The number of strides in between four and five will not be a factor unless it's too slow. That would change the rhythm. Or too flat, that would also change the rhythm and the shape of the jump. This is the spooky log.
And Rolo just takes that in stride.
Not spooky for him. You'll notice Augusta sink in here. He's going to touch the saddle to hold the lead. That's the key part, watching the ride to that jump. The horse is thinking about turning left. The lead could happen prior to the takeoff. She did a great job keeping the horse straight.
Now, this is interesting. The fences 8 and 9, the course designer has presented a couple of different options. You can either choose to jump the option jump that Augusta did back to this jump on the end, or you could jump the jump on the end and make the left turn. It's going to be interesting to see what riders choose what track.
This is a very comfortable two stride. Finishing up.
That was quite lovely.
Watch for the lead change. There we go. Super. So that's a really good first round for us to talk about. a little bit of a clinic on how to ride, going first, not only going first in the class, but how to ride everything in rhythm. She had a great rhythm everywhere. She was very straight. Her horse jumped in perfect style. And I think we'll see some nice scores that come out of that.
And I think even here, when she picked it up just in Nicholsworth, it was done so beautifully and smoothly. You didn't really notice an obvious pace change.
Just waiting on the scores. All right, here we go. Judge 4-1, an 84, panel 2, an 86, 8 high option points, 4 from each panel, a real good start of 178. She made that look pretty easy.
She sure did. It was very smooth, very lovely, very positive.
So you can see here and how Augusta
second in our order. There's been a little bit of a rider, a change in the order because our rider has been changed. Mitchell Endicott is riding 1023. This is a likely story. Likely story belongs to the Enchantment Farms LLC, and the trainer is Krista Endicott.
So Mitch is coming in, taking a tour as we talked about, letting the horse get on the field, take a deep breath. These horses did have a warm-up class out here at some point earlier in the week, I'm told. But we've been judging all week, and we haven't judged any hunters in the Grand Prix field this week. So they're out here for the first time today, for sure.
Which is, I think, great in the sense that, you know, it's sort of part of the challenge of the Derby that a horse can boldly go out onto the big field and be able to handle these jumping efforts. That part is kind of a test in itself.
Mm-hmm. Well, watch the rider's positions, their leg, which is their heel and calf, their base, which is thigh and seat, their upper body, which is torso, head and shoulders, which includes then independent hands and arms. That's a big part to galloping in the Grand Prix field. And at this level of riding, this is not a novice hunter course. This is not meant for the novice rider or the green horse that isn't confident. This is meant for a technical ride. You have to be able to put the horse together for that lead change. And as you see, he knows he has to get his pace up. Slowing down a little for the lead change made it so that he had to then reestablish his rhythm. Not the exact same rhythm we saw from the first horse. Smart choice, the low side.
Interesting, yeah. Mitch chose the low side of that.
This looks to me to be a little bit of a greener horse, maybe, or a little less experienced in derbies, maybe.
Yeah, that would be my take on it as well.
Beautiful type.
Jumped that beautifully. Once again, he chose the lower option.
Yeah, and this is the horse that we're talking about that we mentioned a little earlier, not specifically this horse, but this type of horse that just needs his hand held a little through the leg seat and hand of the rider to be confident. He's a lovely horse. He has a beautiful jump, but he just has to be given just a little more direction. Beautifully done by Mitch.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when a horse looks this good through the bridle, we love this expression, but it can also tell you that the horse is laying on the rider's leg a little. Mitch is doing a great job of supporting this horse. When he feels the horse, just sort of take a little look, his leg is right there, and it just smoothly works to the distance.
Yeah, and it's nice because nothing ever changes, mm-hmm. which would be alarming to a lesser experienced horse like this. Mitch just is right there to kind of support without letting the horse think there's any problem.
And he's taken the other option, which you discussed,
mm-hmm. Oh, yes,
jumping the end jump first and then coming back to the vertical.
And there he chose the high.
and the long gallop to the two stride.
Once again, the lead change.
Yeah, we've seen this horse need to do the left to right lead change. And when that happens, it's important that the horse stay going forward through the lead change so the rhythm isn't affected visually watching as the horse is being judged around the course. So that'll be something that I'm sure they're well aware of. They did a beautiful job today, but just that little bit of difference will be reflected in the horse's score.
And notice Mitch trotting this circle on the loose rein. That is actually a requirement. Now with the COVID protocols, we don't jog the horses ahead of time. So the judges are looking to see that final circle on the loose rein to judge for soundness.
And we have a total score of 166, but we don't know how that's broken down until we see the scoreboard.
Right.
The scoreboard will give us the judges' each panel score. And there we go. That's what we need to see.
Okay. So
the 81 from both panels and two high options makes for the 166.
One of our two amateur riders in the field.
Here we have Verdict and Alexis Meadows entering the ring. Verdict has a pretty long career in these derbies. I think that Alexis has owned him now maybe for about a year. This is the horse that Nick Hannes competed so successfully on at Derby Finals. Alexis rides as an amateur owner, and she's certainly developing a great partnership with this horse.
Well, that would be the ideal match to have an amateur on a well-experienced horse, and also be aware that through the Artie Hawkins International Hunter Derby class today, there will be a high award amateur, and there will be a high award for a junior as
right.
well.
Right, yeah.
Alexo's just galloping right on down to the first jump like she's in any normal ring that she rides around on.
Exactly, totally.
Just cantering right along.
Be interesting to see what she chooses here.
Very confident. The horse couldn't be any straighter.
You could be confident in this guy because he's certainly done some great classes. And she chooses the high there.
It's helpful for the horse to land on both leads on a hunter. It's helpful not only for their style, that their legs are even in the air, mm-hmm. but it's also helpful that they land on both leads to be able to keep the rhythm, just like she's doing here, to the option that she chooses at the swoops.
And there was a little bit of an adjustment there, and so he changed his lead prematurely, a couple strides before the big oxer.
So as a rider approaches the number three jump, they need quite a bit of power, and you saw her get jumped a little loose as she did pick the high option and just got jumped a little loose. This horse made a great effort. She wasn't just quite aware of it, but she'll get better at it by doing these classes, and she'll know that what's coming just like that.
Exactly.
She did a great correction there. They have to put their heels down and wait for the horse to finish the jump because it's wider, and it happens. The jump itself takes a little longer to unfold than the normal hunter class pops her out of the lines.
And it's wonderful to see her boldly go to the high options, even maybe after being jumped a little bit loose there on jump number three. It didn't intimidate her. She continues on, which ultimately is going to make her really good at this.
For sure. She has a plan. She's sticking to it.
Yep.
This is a big jump as well, jump number seven. Mm-hmm. She's got more pace. And she kept the horse on the lead. She corrected
yes.
herself from the earlier line that we saw to jump three. That was great. The way you keep a horse straight to any jump is both legs through your seat to the contact to the bridle through your arms. In any situation where you're on a diagonal, you have diagonal aids. You have the outside leg, the inside rein, making sure the horse stays on the lead. If the rider isn't attuned to that and the horse starts going a little to the left or to the right, to the outside, the horse will swap its lead. So Sue, let's talk a little bit about how hard when you're judging do you you affect a swap. What, talk a little bit about that for our viewers.
Well, I think for me, a swap off the ground doesn't make me crazy. I note it kind of as a tiebreaker, unless a horse does it super consistently. And in that case, I look at it a little harder. In this case, where she actually created the lead change a couple of strides in front of the jump, you might be just a little harder on that one.
Yeah, I think any time a horse is not straight, it's a more major deduction than when a horse obviously is. And if a horse, it's natural for horses to gallop and a lot of times pat the ground. A horse going straight and having a great round, it's a minor deduction. I watched a video of Artie Hawkins this morning, and he was talking about a rider that won a class and it had the best round. It actually was Leslie Steele. And she galloped right around at the garden and ended up with a swap of one jump. But the horse jumped beautiful and dead straight.
Yeah.
And they took a deduction and it was still the best round. That's possible to do. But ideally, you want the horses to go in between leg and hand, stay straight, stay on their leads, and jump a beautiful jump.
Coming in now, we have Cartier du Rouet, Jenny Karazisis, in the irons for owner Heidi Kane. And the trainer is Nicole Kane. And Nicole had gotten injured when she first brought this horse into the country. And so she gave the ride to Jenny. And Jenny has continued on getting some good placings in a couple of derbies so far with this horse.
Jenny has a very long resume of success. For many, many years, she is the gold standard of punter riders nationally. The last standings that I have seen in regards to the derbies have Jenny's on top in the derby standings, and she is also the recent West Coast WCHR Spectacular winner, the $100,000 class earlier this year.
Actually, I think she won both the $50,000 and the $100,000.
There you go.
Yeah.
Now, for our viewers watching, we saw the head-on shot of this horse at the first jump. That is a very different angle than what the judges are seeing from the side. This horse's legs went a little to the side, but he jumped a beautiful jump. So that'll be a very different view than what the judges saw from the side.
Yeah, that's a really interesting thing. You know, the perspective from which you watch the class or judge the class can have a really big impact on scores. I know that I've often been asked by amateurs and juniors about how come this judge had this score and the other judge had the other score. Well, it really is based on perspective. Sometimes you'll watch a jump from a certain angle and the horse, it just looks lovely. And from a different angle, you can see a twist or a change in the style. So having a couple of different viewpoints really makes a difference.
I'm watching this horse and he's getting more comfortable as he goes. To me, this horse was holding his breath a little bit at the first three jumps. After he jumped the big swoop oxer, it has a different feel to me now up this line.
He felt good that he was successful there. I think now he's feeling pretty confident. We'll see how he likes this.
You'll watch the rider sink into the saddle, a little deeper seat. They will all, I will guarantee you, anyone that can see the jump, as in choosing a distance, will pick a second distance to that log. The first distance could be a long and iffy, especially if the horse at a jump like that takes a peek a little late on the last stride. So we talk about first distance, which is off the gallop, second distance, which we saw Jenny do to the log, which is a little more connected. And the third distance would be very, very, very steady. So we won't see too many of those on purpose, but we will see the first and second distances used around this track.
Yeah, I think a jump that sort of stands out in the field like the log, it's much plainer, a different shape. To jump that on that first long distance, it's something, boy, you have a long relationship with a horse and absolute confidence.
Yeah, and the rollback from the in-gate too.
Yes, exactly.
So we got a chance to talk about a couple of different ideas about riding around this course with an expert in the saddle. This horse got more confident as he went because of the great contact Jenny gave the horse. She has super horse IQ. She could feel the horse holding its breath. She kept giving it confidence, and we'll see, wait and see what the scores are.
Position one, we have seven.
Here we're seeing the horse really get a good gallop and be confident to this big roll top. That's a spectacular jump.
That was a great jump.
And there you have the perspective Sue was talking about in regards to what the judges could see and not see. And that has a lot to do with where they're sitting in the ring. 75 from panel one and an 80 plus score from panel two. I didn't get the total.
Yeah, I didn't either.
And here comes 580. This is Katie Keering. Katie Keering. She brings Caxay de Soul, 580. An entry owned by the
Keering. Here we have our fourth, fifth horse in the order now. Caxay de Soul. Katie Keering owns. The trainer is Rachel Fields. And Katie is in the irons.
Katie Keering, 580.
Katie looks like, is Katie a professional?
I'm not sure.
So if you know jump number three is coming, you're going to start with a little more pace than this.
This is an interesting horse. They have just switched his job very recently. He was a jumper, was doing the meter 45s in Europe, and they've decided to make him up into a hunter. So he just started doing hunters the second half of thermal. So it's going to be really interesting to see how he is out on this big field.
Lovely jumper.
Yes, for
sure. Beautiful style. And because of his jumper experience, she may be very, very confident. Now she's picking up the pace a little. I would like to have seen that rhythm a little more consistent starting.
Yeah, it's always nice to start on that lick. I always think that, you know, the one that you would be in the middle of the line, just go boldly to the first jump.
Yeah, and the reason for that is that the judges are looking for the five factors of jumping. As they're scoring the horse, they're watching the horse's pace, the horse's line, the horse's balance and impulsion being the desire to go forward, and then the distance. We saw the distance get a little deep for her at jump number four, and that had to do with the ability to balance the horse as he started on the long gallop to it.
It's interesting, given this horse's jumper background, that so far she's chosen all the lower options.
I think it's, and the lead change a little late there.
Slow
I couldn't
there.
See in the bushes. But I think if it's a first derby and it's an early adventure into the hunter ranks, which clearly it's a great fit.
Right.
Getting to know the horse in these situations is very different than in the jumper ring. So, you know, bonus points to them for giving this horse a great first experience. And Katie's a junior getting mileage here and doing a great job.
Yes, she is.
Is a great position. Set a few distances, one a little deep, one a little long, a little out of rhythm. I would mark that on my card. But very confident. And I think they could be very pleased with their outing today.
Yeah, a great experience to get to gallop and jump out on this big field for a junior rider.
We'll wait for the scores. There she is, trotting her circle. This jump got a little long. The horse saw one less. She was thinking, oh, that was the beautiful swoop. I think it was jump seven I was thinking they were going to. That was beautiful at the swoop jump.
It's a 64 position, two at the 70. There were two high options.
This one got deep.
The total score now of 138.
He sure handles that well.
Yeah, he did.
So we see the total of 138, 64 from panel one, 70 from panel two. And I think that also was reflective of the late change we saw after Jones.
Yes, I would say so.
This is silent majority. Fine young professional rider Sean Cassidy is at the reins here of silent majority.
Here we have silent majority, number 1010, Sean Cassidy in the irons for the Meadow Farm, trained by Corinne Bevis.
Sean is an excellent rider. He's come up through the equitation ranks. He's been a catch rider through his entire junior years. And now as a professional, he spent time in Europe. He's one to watch in regards to a very correct position. You can see that he has weight down in his heels. He's using his seat to give this horse a little confidence to canter a little longer, not lower,
and
with
this
its balance.
This horse is actually a green, first year green horse. So, you know, he is relatively new at this job, though he has had some placings in the derbies through the thermal circuit.
That head-on shot was fantastic to see just how Sean used his automatic release to keep the horse very confident and straight, cantering away from the jump. Back in the days when we learned to jump, Sue, we had a phrase, you know, a getaway stepper, ride them through their arc.
Yeah.
And that helped the horses have a very good first step in a line. And we're watching Sean do that with this horse. Brave to go to the high side.
Absolutely. He seems very comfortable, this horse.
Yeah. Had a hard rub at jump two, and now he seems to be really in his zone.
Yeah, I love his expression. He looks really interested, anxious to get to the jumps, not anxious in a bad way, but just, this looks great.
Yeah, great expression to the bridle.
Yeah.
Their ears are up there.
Boy, he didn't mind that a bit. That was adorable.
That was great. And a real good ride by Sean. Did such a super job. But we see the live feed catching up to jump eight, on its way to nine.
Yep. He chose to do the end jump with the left turn back. And once again, the high option.
Well, I guarantee you the rhythm that Sean used on course is not quite as rapid as the video is showing us at the moment. We'll wait and see what the scores are. We apologize for having a moment where the live stream was getting organized and settled in. Lovely horse, great ride, great example to watch Sean in his position. Here's the automatic release. Yep, just followed the horse nicely. Very subtle, very discreet. Look how the heel and the leg and the seat are helping the horse confidently stay on the lead to that jump for a first-year horse.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
He looks very comfortable for a first-year horse out there.
Yeah, and the judges thought so too, Sue. So a total of 171, panel one and 80, panel two and 83, plus the high options. That's a great round.
Absolutely.
Goes into the second spot.
The rider's experience helping a green horse is immeasurable on this field.
Jesse,
I don't know. There's just no better way to put it.
Right.
The horse needs a little confidence. The riders are feeling the horses get confident, and the rounds are and the scores are going accordingly up into the 80s. That's fantastic.
Now coming into the ring, we have 986, Attendu de Lenoir. Augusta's back with the ride for the owner, Ashland Farms.
This one is Attendu de Lenoir Z. Attendu de Lenoir Z.
This is a little bigger confirmation than the first horse.
Looks, this horse has actually won International Derby at Tryon. He's had some great placings in the equitation as well.
Yeah, we see a crossover frequently of horses from the 7 and 8 year old jumpers or the equitation divisions, especially when they have such quality jump. You know, she showed tremendous poise there. The horse laid on her leg and she just sat into the horse a little deeper, kept the rhythm of her leg, and just gave that horse the confidence to just jump that beautiful jump. Had she overridden it, we might have seen something different, but she did it exactly right. Beautiful jump there as well.
I always love to watch Augusta's instincts when it comes to riding. She has really good riding instincts and seems to inspire horses to jump well.
For our viewers watching, you can see this horse lay on her leg about 3 strides out. Not so much than the second jump of the line, and she did pick the lower one. She also knew she had the right to left lead change coming. That could have been a very, very good strategic plan for a good clean change. But when the horse lays on the rider's leg 3 strides out, the leg already has to be there. Intermediate riders fix it after the fact, and advanced riders like what you're seeing with Augusta and Jenny and Sean Cassidy so far, their leg is already on the horse. So when the horse lays on their leg, the support is already there. It isn't that the horse lays on their leg and they put their leg on. And that supportive leg comes from stepping down into your heel, stretching your calf around the barrel of the horse. Her stirrup could be a little closer to the ball of her foot. It's a little on her toe on the left side, just to be picky. Doesn't relate to her score. I just would hate to lose a stirrup and have it affect my score later on.
I don't know. It looks to me like she's got fairly wide treads on the bottom of the stirrups. I think she kind of knows where she is there.
Well, she shows in all the rings. You know, that's an interesting comment with the wide treads on the stirrups. Mm-hmm. In the old days, the Steuben stirrup, and you would know the stirrup was right on the ball of the foot. That lead change is going to hurt her a little bit. With these wider treads, it does look like the stirrup's a little closer to the toe.
Mm-hmm.
For us traditional types, we notice that. Yeah, great round. The left to right lead change at the end, the only thing that I really saw.
A little bit rough, yeah.
Great type.
Absolutely. I love the way she's so in her nice forward seat, always with the motion. I love her style.
Well, you get to that from being a balanced rider. Everyone would like to have that position.
There in slow motion, you could see that was a little bit rough.
So the total of 170, panel 1 and 82, panel 2 and 82, with the deductions having been taken, and that puts her in a real good place, probably, I'm guessing, close to third, maybe?
Yeah, I haven't kept track.
Unofficially.
Yeah.
To be a rider that rides with the motion, we say there are 3 ways to ride, with the motion, behind the motion, and ahead of the motion. Rarely ever is ahead of the motion suggested. Behind the motion is when these riders are sinking into the saddle and sitting a little deeper to give their horses confidence. Otherwise, you're seeing the riders ride with a light 3-point, which we say is with the motion.
Here's Nick Hannes in on his first ride today, a horse called Caldiano, owned by the Double Down Farm LLC. This horse is a newer horse to Nick's program. He's actually been a very successful jumper at the higher levels and actually still sometimes does the jumpers. But Nick really felt like this horse had potential as a Derby horse. So here he is. In fact, he actually got a third place finish in the $25,000 International Derby in Thermal.
I think that's not an unusual, you know, comment. And again, to go back to historical times in the 70s and the 80s, you would see horses frequently do the Hunters, the Equitation, and the Grand Prix. And even some horses like Stands Ablaze and some of the others we saw went on to do team, U.S. team events. So horses that do multiple divisions, we had a phrase we coined back east, which was a jack of all trades.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, many times growing up, you had one horse to do it all on. That was your only option. Of course, there were many fewer classes in those days. You know, the junior hunters started at 3-6. That was your only choice. So it was possible. You might do a major equitation class, a junior hunter class, and a jumper class on the same animal.
It's not unusual. This day and age, not as often. People, as you pointed out, have multiple horses.
Yeah.
Exactly. Watching Nick navigate this horse around, I'm just sort of letting, this is the moment I've been waiting for, to see this horse relax and gallop.
Mm-hmm. It's fun, though. Nick says riding this one because of his jumper experience, he has no qualms about the high options on this horse. Now he's going to opt for the left turn as well.
This horse has done, Nick's done a great job with this horse cantering around. The horse wanted to get a little up on the bridle on the left lead earlier in the course, jumps 4 and 5, and has since taken a deep breath and really has put together the second part of the course beautifully. Nick is a super horseman. He'll get that leveled out. Here's a little bit where we see him, a little bit up in the bridle.
Yeah.
Just a little bit there.
I think it's a bit of a tribute to Nick as a rider to watch this horse progress as he goes through the round, you know, from where he was in that frame to where he is right here.
Yeah, exactly the moment when he took a breath.
Yeah.
Finishing his circle.
Position one, we have looks an 86 there.
Two, we have an 84. There were four high options. That's a 178. That's also a tie.
And judges loved it. 86. From panel one, 84, a total of 178. Best jumper in the class so far. And that was fantastic.
Oh, interesting. Our first horse, Rolo, had the same score, the 178.
Right, and they'll have a tie-breaking panel. And so panel number one is the tiebreaker with the higher score.
Yeah.
Mr. Mitchell Indicott is back with his next ride in the contest as we go to the ninth and
beautiful day. The fog's burning off.
First round.
Yes,
you can see the sun coming out.
Welcome, Hollywood.
Always great at Blenheim.
Absolutely. Here we have Mitchell Endicott back. This time he's riding a horse called Hollywood. Hollywood is owned by Mackenzie Greer and Krista Endicott, once again, the trainer. I don't have a lot of information on this horse. So I guess we'll wait and see. Not sure what his typical level of competition is.
Well, we know it's a horse with some experience because he wouldn't get to an International Hunter Derby without it.
Exactly.
In one form or another.
Right.
So as the horse came in, his ears went up a little, his head went up a little. But now he's cantering very level, and I hope Mitch has a great round.
What do you think of that, Diane, as a judge, when you are watching and you see a horse come in the ring, and for just a moment it looks a little bit like, what am I doing here?
Well, I think it's normal for a horse a lot of times to sort of look around. I think you see some trainers take a lot of time walking in the ring to make sure a horse has a moment intellectually, the brain of the horse, to settle in. It's not really anything other than I just note, what I want to see is this horse drop its head and neck so that it can just relax on the front side of the jump a little more. Hopefully we'll see that. We've seen a few horses as they make this turn and they pick up the pace, carry a little more pace, and then be able to jump a little more comfortably with a lower neck. this horse's conformation is sort of built this way. So
yes, he is.
But that a little bit in the bridle,
A little above the bit.
Yeah, that's an advanced hand and an expert, which is what Mitch is. The contact has to be just a little smoother for the hunter score.
Yeah, and I think Mitch is doing such a great job supporting this horse, because just from his expression, you get the sense that he's a little concerned about his surroundings, maybe.
And that goes back to all of us talking about these riders. Mitch has great experience riding in the fields, but a lot of times horses have not been out in areas where the boundaries are wider than this. This is a field.
Yeah, exactly.
And horse is getting comfortable with that, but he's doing a great job navigating this. As the horse is just a little, we see it in the bridle just a little bit.
And you notice sometimes the horse's little bit of fussiness just in preparation for the lead change. That's not a, like there, for instance, it's not a terrible thing, but it's certainly one of those things that you're going to notice the difference between a horse that just very calmly steps into his change and one who has to question it a little bit, like this horse.
Well, we talk about rhythm, straightness, and style, and everything about a hunter, the higher the score, the smoother the round.
Exactly.
So anything that deducts away from smoothness will be something that we all want to work on as trainers. And this may be a little bit more of an equitation horse, getting great mileage and doing a great job out on this field. I know they've had, because I've had the privilege of judging at the Whitethorn Equitation American Champ Tradition of Excellence class, the Whitethorn American Tradition of Excellence Equitation class out on this field. And so horses getting used to this field at different times of the year, getting ready for that. I wouldn't put it past these people to be very, very organized for later on in this horse's career.
Absolutely.
Or even this horse show. I don't know the schedule, but maybe there's equitation classes out here.
Yeah.
But take a shot.
Right.
It's a great jumper. Well ridden by Mitch.
Yeah, Mitch is a very good hand.
I would just raise my hand with a horse that has a change like this, only because then when your hand is below the bit, it's a little bit on the bars of the mouth. If you raise your hand a little, even though in hunters, we always talk about keeping our hands low, but if you raise your hand a little bit, it'll keep the straight line corner of the mouth and make that just a hint, just a nickel's worth smoother. 167, ranked 6th, panel 1 and 80, panel 2 of 79. We've got people texting on my messenger and saying from Arizona, thank you for tuning in. If you want to find me on Messenger, you can send me a message or a question or a comment. I look forward to answering any questions we get.
Here we have entering the ring a horse called Out of Office. Ariel Marx is in the irons for Mary Bernardo. This is from Betty Barron's stable in Arizona. And this is a very young horse as Derby's go. He's just 7. He's a first-year horse. He's done a lot of national derbies in Zone 8, but this is his very first international hunter derby.
Well, this is a big ask. A first international hunter derby on the grass at Blenheim. Other than derby finals, I don't think it gets much higher on the list. So let's watch and see Ariel navigate this horse around this course. She's a good rider. She comes out of a great program. I've known Betty Barron my entire career. Super horsewoman. And if Ariel is riding her horses, you know, she has a great mentor.
Well, and I've just watched Ariel get better and better and better. She's been with Betty now for about 10 years. And I always thought when I first saw her, I thought she was quite good, but she just continues to get better and better and better.
I would like to see Ariel sink into the saddle. I would like to see her give this horse a little more support in the tack as jump number three is coming up. She's taken a wide approach with a good gallop, but I think she's going to have to sink in for this jump. That adjustment ended up being just a little deep for me, and I think if she'd have had her seat in the tack and the contact just a little earlier, she would have found it to be able to let go. Would have just helped the height of the jump is what I'm referencing. Beautiful style. They're the same thing. Mm-hmm. As the line is getting away from her, she's counting whatever number she wants to do there. The horse is getting a little deeper. She realizes it. Then she has to make the adjustment. If she was already in the tack, it would be smoother. Fewer deductions is being the point.
Oh, he took a look at that. There, the first year newbie came out just a little bit. He noted that log.
And the riders are aware of the fact that the horses don't see it. And then as they do see it, he raised up a little bit. She was in the tack for that jump. Otherwise, it could have even been a little bit of a harsher reaction. So she did a great job riding to that jump. But that feeling I'd like to have more around the rest of the course. If a rider is attempting to be light in the tack to show the confidence of the horse, that's great as long as it shows the confidence of the horse. Otherwise, sink in like she did right here. That feeling, and she gets a higher jump out of it. So that's the point of contact between your leg, seat, and hand. The other point is the balance of the horse. Just a little seat in the saddle just elevates the horse's balance and allows for the horse just a little more natural.
I'd say that was a pretty good job, though, for a guy's first time in the National Derby.
They're going to buy a log. They'll be selling logs after this class.
Oh, that part's true.
Yeah, they'll be the log jump will be in everybody's ring. Like the log at Devon.
Yeah.
When the log, everybody had a log because if you went to Devon and to jump the log. High options gives us a total in the
first round of 156. Oh yeah. There
you go. She did a good job there.
Yeah, she did because he really was
took a look.
A little suspicious.
It reflected in his scores, a total of 156. Mm-hmm. Judge panel number one, 78, panel number two is 74. She did a great job navigating that green horse around. I just would like to see her sink in so it could be a little smoother. I think those scores would go up exponentially because of that. Mm-hmm. Anytime you're changing something on a hunter, you're going to get a deduction. Keep that in mind.
Yeah, anything that just looks like it interrupts. This is young Gabrielle Sokola. Here we have Incandescent. Coming on course with Gabrielle Sokoloff, who is in the irons and also owns this horse, who's trained by Tasha Bisseke.
Real good head-on shot there. Beautiful type. Looks to me maybe slightly lop-eared. I'm always fond
love
of
the lop-eared horses.
Fond of a lop-eared horse.
This horse has been most recently doing the Junior Hunters, and he actually was reserve champion in the International Derby in Temecula and has qualified to go to Derby finals. So this is probably a great preparation for this horse.
Always.
And the size shows this high option and stayed with him beautifully in the air there.
Yeah, great job. The size of the arena is a part of Derby finals. Also the width and the impressive visual of the jumps. The natural material that's used at Derby finals, the width of the jumps, and the gallop of the arena.
Yeah.
Those are all the factors that make getting ready for Derby finals part of the preparation would be, I would put all three of those factors in my preparation.
Yeah, that and all the amazing decoration, which can certainly get a horse's attention. He didn't even give a look at that.
It's rider-esque, really good timing.
She does. She's doing a great job.
Pace, line, balance of the horse, impulsion, how much power do I need, and then the distance. She's doing a great job navigating that.
She's choosing to do the right turn back with this option. I love the way she stays up out of the tack and then just on the approach, the last few
sinks
steps,
in.
She just sinks
mm-hmm.
behind the pommel a little bit.
And we say sink as opposed to sit.
Right.
You want to sink with a little hollowed lower back, exactly what she has. Let that left leg get that changed and let the horse drift to the rail. You'll even get an extra point out of us judging if you keep the horse straight in that change. That was a good round.
Mm-hmm. It was. Got a couple of great juniors in this class.
California does a wonderful job with the invention of every equitation class possible.
That's for sure.
And the opportunities the show managers make, that Stephanie Wheeler has made in the Blenheim team here, have made for these hunters to get out on this field particular. They do have another grass ring that they show in all week long, but this is much bigger and a fabulous, fabulous ring. There we go, an 85, total of 16.5, an 85 from panel one, an 83 from panel two, and
that's a
fantastic
pretty good score.
0.5 goes into the third spot right now. A super ride there for Gabby.
Without the show managers making these opportunities available, we as exhibitors don't benefit as much when we carry our competition east, and of course everything from California is east. So we really appreciate Stephanie Wheeler Lightner's opportunity to make this available for the exhibitors.
Caraggio, 1189.
And here we have Caraggio, ridden by Emma Lindstrom for owner Judy Salen. The trainer is Jenny Brown. This horse was bred in Canada and does the high performance hunters. And he's actually had a couple of good placings in international derbies this year. His owner loves to watch him show with Emma, who has been an essential part of Jenny's Shadow Brook team for a number of years now.
Got a great gallop. This horse is very comfortable with this.
He looks it.
She's carrying quite a bit of pace. She started with pace and she's carrying quite a bit of pace. It all matches to this swoop oxer.
It just gives you such a good sense when they step into the ring and strike off at a nice gallop. And, you know, it just catches your eye, makes you pay attention, makes them look bold from the beginning, which is wonderful.
It matches.
Yeah, exactly. Emma's got a beautiful position.
That comes from her weight down in her heel. She practices, I'm sure, every day on her own balance so that she can properly balance the horses. This rollback turn is a little deeper in the saddle. Beautiful.
Oh, that he just handled that with such aplomb.
Beautiful.
This horse looks so comfortable out here.
Fabulous. The rhythm has not changed. his rhythm setting at all the different fences, the verticals, the oxers, the long approaches, it hasn't changed one step.
Yeah.
You get a sense of gallop without being rushed, and scope and style. She saw that about 10 strides out.
She just gallops boldly right down to the line.
She saw that about 10 strides out.
That was a beautifully ridden
round. That was a good round.
It was a beautifully ridden round. Yes, for sure.
I don't know what the scores will reflect, but as far as watching at home, that's a round to watch over and over again if you can find it to watch, because the rhythm did not change from the beginning to the end. Everything was exactly straight, beautifully ridden, and the horse's style was exactly the same over every jump. He wasn't jumping higher over one jump and lower over another. Every jump matched.
And that's something you can't always instill, with the exception of giving them lots of experience till they get comfortable with all the different kinds of efforts and heights.
84.5. 85 from position two, four high options.
The judges liked it too. She's going to be in with a 177.5. She's in unofficially into third, panel one and 84.5, panel two and 85, and they liked it too. I just think that was a great example of Hunter riding and watching a horse go where every jump matched and the rhythm didn't change from beginning to end.
Yeah, she did a wonderful job. Spot with a great trip with. Now we have a horse called Clearing. Haley Hall rides and owns, and this is also trained by Tasha Bissake. This horse does both the equitation and the derbies, and in fact, at one point was a high junior jumper. He's had numerous talent search wins, so we'll see how he is in our international derby today.
That would be the definition of jack of all trades.
Yeah, exactly. That's good.
That would be the definition. Let's see what she can get done today.
Hunter's just a little over a year ago, and they were fourth in their first national derby together.
Cute.
The partnership of the amateur.
Now this horse goes with a little more rhythm, a little more energy than the horse we just saw. Different conformation than the gray horse that just went. Different conformation, beautiful type, jumps great, just different types of horses.
I think that's part of it too, from a rider's standpoint, is really being able to know the one that you're riding. Not every horse is close to the same. Bigger strided, shorter strided, certain different types of feel in the air. So the longer you have a partnership, probably the more successful you become. I guess it's just like any other sport where you play in pairs.
Yeah, and getting the match of a horse and a rider, and get, as you just said, and getting to know Sue, your horse. She took the first distance to the swoopy oxer, which we saw a little earlier, and then the horse laid on her leg a little late, which made that feeling of she was getting there long or out of rhythm. To me, if I were marking my card, I would have just made a notation about the rhythm there.
I think oftentimes, you know, making sure that the horse is there, has enough impulsion through the turn, then when you come out of the turn, you have the opportunity to make a decision and actually have oftentimes many choices. Whereas if you don't stay attuned to your pace, then sometimes you're left with a little bit of a last minute choice, and that's when it changes. It makes it look different.
This rider has a definite plan. Her plan was to be very definite at the swoop oxer and very definite at the log, and we witnessed that. I'd like to see that done a little smoother, a little more subtle. It would just help the smoothness and the feeling of the round, which helps the score, which is the point. Good jumper. A little heading home. He knows that cute expression through the bridle. Well, that was a good opportunity for this rider to ride a confident horse around out on this field.
For sure.
And he's a great jack of all trades. I can see why his resume is exactly what you read off.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure this has been a wonderful experience for Haley, just to get the opportunity to go out on this field. And can't ever underestimate the amount of experience it takes to get really good at this.
A 154 overall, right on the bubble for the top 12 to come back, a 74 from panel one, 72 from panel two. So we'll keep an eye on that. She's right on the bubble for the top 12 to return for the handy.
Caracesus, our Derby queen, coming in. Let's talk a little bit about Big Shot, owned by Dulce Lou Morris from Malibu, California. Big Shot, ridden by a former recipient of the Arthur Hawkins Award, which we'll be presenting later, was U.S.
Joining us now, we have Big Shot, ridden by Jenny Caracesus and owned by Dulce Lou Morris. Coast trains this duo.
And you know what happened week eight?
They won. So much you could say about this horse. He and Jenny have pretty much, well, he's grown up with her in the saddle. They know each other like two bookends. Jenny said this horse feels like family to her. And of course, his resume reads like a who's who. He won both of the big derbies at Thermal, the $50,000 one and the $100,000 spectacular. So Big Shot is a horse to watch for sure, and Jenny, the consummate hunter rider.
That's a perfect first jump. She set her pace, she found the line, she supported the horse as he laid just a little bit on her leg, noticing the distance, and then her arm relaxed. It was a beautiful first jump.
You know, it's interesting when you've talked about horses' carriage. This is a horse who kind of likes to carry himself a little up in front. And that's not a negative. It's just a difference. He's a very confident horse. He's got a beautiful way of cantering across the grass, a great style of jumping. But his carriage is a little more up than some.
Yeah, this, I think, the best mover we've seen. Quality of this horse. He's a little up. She's a little guarded as she gets to the oxers. Of course, the swoop oxer she was quite supportive of. And then this one is well up into the corner there with the scoreboard.
I can't help myself, though. I love seeing horses up in bright like this when they're galloping out on a field. And Jenny's adjustments were so subtle there.
This horse has also taken a deep breath as he now canters to fence number seven. We've seen that with quite a few of them. He's had a great round. There are a few little minor things that'll be adjusted, but in general, this horse has now taken a deep breath. To your point, he's lowered his head carriage. She's looser in the arm. You know, winning the International Hunter Derby is a marathon. Make sure you get a great round in the first round.
Yeah.
Don't leave any points on the field if you can avoid it. And then nail it in the handy.
Exactly, yeah.
I think that's a good round. A couple of moments I noticed, I'm sure the judges did as well, where she just had to hold his hand a little bit. Really a brilliant round. One of my all-time mentors always said to me, you know, it's the first jump and the last jump. And she certainly did all of that and all the jumps in between. It's a great replay there. But watch here. She's just going to hold his hand. Oh, we didn't get to see it. pulled his hand a little into that corner. What we mean by that is that she's closing her fingers and just taking just a little contact as the horse's neck is rocking in the canter.
Oh my, they
yeah, I'm not surprised. 192 overall, that's ranks number one. Those are the high scores we've seen today, a 94 and a 90. And I'm talking about in regards to how we saw Jenny's arm relax and be able to hold his hand. I think we'll even see it looser in the hand.
Country's leading riders in the series. This is Jamie Saylor.
Next in our ring, we have Get Rowdy. Get Rowdy is owned by the Teton Farms LLC and ridden today by Jamie Saylor. $43,000 here. This horse has had a good career prior to Jamie riding him. Carly Postel did. He was Horse of the Year in the High Performance in 2019. Jamie has fairly recently taken over the ride on this one. Jamie currently ranks about 22nd on the leading rider list, but this girl, she's a great hand in all sorts of areas. She's a great jumper rider, great hunter rider, very confident up there. So this should be a fun pair to watch.
Right away, she set her pace.
Yep.
We'll have to watch that in the scores. Coming head on, that horse looked like he might not have jumped up right off the ground. It might have taken him a little while to get to the top of his arc there.
Yeah, it's so difficult, though, watching from this perspective because it's straight on. And from the side, that could look completely different. It's just sometimes you'll see things straight on that you don't see from the side. Jamie did say that it's really fun to ride this horse out on a big field because he's kind of a quiet natured horse. So he tends to pick up his interest level when he gets out on a big field like this.
Mm-hmm. The adrenaline.
Yeah.
Got a great gallop and a great jump. Oftentimes horses are not stabilized galloping as much as we gallop in the derbies. Practicing that on a 13-foot step with the horse's balance properly back to front, as we say, longitudinal, back to front. We have back to front balance and lateral side to side balance. This horse is really straight side to side. It just appeared that maybe on that bigger step to start with, he might not have been quite as stabilized. Now he looks like he's totally comfortable with it.
Well, it's an interesting thing too, because nowadays with horses being forced to be in smaller enclosures, smaller areas, they don't get the same idea of just riding flat across country like back in the old days. So practicing the gallop is really kind of an important thing. It's rare anymore that you get, well, back east it's different, but out here in California, having a lot of space to get to gallop is very limited.
Right, and getting ready for any of these types of classes or finals, the trainers, I'm sure, are very astute to knowing they have to find ways to do that. Galloping all the schooling areas in a straight line or something. This horse had a good round.
Yeah, he sure did.
My only comment, a beautiful ride. Mm-hmm. I mean, she's got a great position and great horse IQ and beautiful timing. My only comment was that his balance at the first jump. We'll see what the scores reflect.
Yeah, it's hard to say what it looked like from the side, because they definitely have quite a different view than we do.
Great example of going straight for the change and changing on a straight line. That's textbook. There she's using that left leg to stay on the lead. She's got the opening right rein slightly to the right. Perfect. That's textbook to watch that.
Jamie's a great rider.
Mm-hmm.
83 from position one.
And I always love that she inspires horses to go forward. That's kind of her strong suit for sure.
Yeah, good round. 83, total of 175, 83 from panel one, 84 from panel two, and 175.5 unofficially into six. Good round.
At 175.5.
and the fog is totally gone.
Here's Augusta Iwasaki back with her next ride.
Oh, and here we have Augusta back again, this time on Small Social. And Small Social is owned by Iwasaki and Riley. Small Social has done quite a bit in the large junior hunters. An interesting thing about this horse is that he used to be one of Will Simpson's jumpers. Now he is a consummate junior hunter.
One of Will Simpson's jumpers.
She was the great type. Hunter. He has a lot of chrome, as we say. That's a lot of white.
Which can either work for or against you because it does draw your eye. So you hope that if you have lots of flash that you also have very good style.
That was a beautiful jump.
It sure was.
She had a nice pace to start with. She just let it crescendo into the base of the jump. The jump shaped the shape of the horse's effort, and it was just beautifully ridden.
She rode well there too, because you could just see a little bit of question in the horse's expression, and she never faltered. She just kept saying, yep, we're right here, my friend, right here.
As a rider, she felt the effort this horse made at the jump before the log, and I guarantee you she's calculating the support that needs to follow here. Perfect.
Mm-hmm. Beautifully done.
Horse makes a big effort. Don't leave him alone at the next jump.
Yeah.
Same thing. She let the gallop right into the base of the jump. The fact that the jump was solid shaped the arc of the horse's effort. It was really beautifully done.
She's done a great job of meeting everything coming forward on this horse. That was a lovely ride.
You'll see her lower her hand as she starts galloping more, and that's to offer more support in between the vertical and the oxer of the in and out. That was really well done.
That was a super round.
That should be very competitive. Right rein.
That was a great effort.
Mm-hmm.
This horse has a great jump.
Super expression through the bridle.
+4, 87+4, 182 total.
Whoa.
Yeah, I thought it would be very competitive, as you did, Sue. So that's a 182 overall, panel number 1 and 87, panel number 2 and 87. Ranked unofficially into second, and super round. We have a great Andy shaping them.
Yeah, for sure. That should be a lot of fun to see. Some very nice horses.
Don't forget that in between rounds, we'll be sending you back to the great horse show announcer, Jeff Gilbert, here at Blenheim, and they'll be presenting the Artie Hawkins Award for 2021. And that'll be a special moment.
Derby course here, first round, an entry owned by the Ashland Farm.
And we have Sean Cassidy back, this time on Casario 8, also owned by Ashland Farms. This is a horse that competes in the 3'9" green hunters and also in the juniors with his owner, Zoe Wolf. He's had some good placings in the International Derbies and the Hunter Spectacular this year during the Desert Circuit.
Nice first jump, dead straight. Great camera angle to show that. Sean is building his pace here. He started building right after the first fence, and he's picked it up a notch. I think we'll see him pick it up again. Yep.
But it's he does it so smoothly mm-hmm. that there's no real abrupt change in pace. You just can see a slight building in the impulsion if you look closely.
That was a great jump.
Mm-hmm. The timing of Sean's upper body is beautiful. You see him just waiting to sort of receive the jump, never gets ahead of the horse.
Well, that brings up a really great point for our viewers, is that the horse jumps up to you, not you bend over to the horse. And the only way that happens is if you jump a little width and a little height to learn that. Now, we all learn 2 point as we're beginners.
Mm-hmm.
These equitation riders and other hunter riders that are watching, even the Grand Prix riders, of course, understand that upper body control comes from a balanced leg and seat. You can't control your upper body if you're trying to figure out how to stay on.
Right.
And you bring up a great point in regards to Sean's position and how it's helping this hunter jump beautiful fences. You want that wither to jump up to you and take as long as it wants to finish getting across the vertical or the oxer. Don't rush the horse. And Augusta and Jenny and Jamie Saylor, all of those riders have this same upper body control.
Yeah, and it's an interesting thing. It's really about timing. You know, there are those who feel as though they sort of stay behind a little bit to get that same idea, but it's not about that. It's really the sense of timing, of holding that position, letting the horse leave the ground and close that angle for you.
Yeah, that was a super round.
Mm-hmm. Very nice, cute horse.
Ashland Farms, I'm sure it was Ken and Emily Smith. Super trainers. Top of the sport.
This horse looks very comfortable out there.
Well, 85.5.
Yeah, it's a nice type.
Mm-hmm.
I could see it doing, crossing over and doing some equitation as well.
Yeah.
Nice round, ranked third. 179 overall, 85.5 from both panels.
And look at that.
They liked it as well as
we
did.
Third highest score so far. Into third with that one.
They have a really good handy shaving.
No kidding. These have been really quite spectacular rounds all the way across the board.
We're not even done with the first round left.
Very, very competitive class.
Only the best at Blenheim.
And here we have Capitulum 2, Caitlin Campbell riding for the SWS Training and Sales. And this is actually trained by Tracy Barman Brooks.
SWS Training and Sales.
Caitlin Campbell has great resume, grew up riding with Rachel Kennedy and out east, and had a wonderful Grand Prix horse that we all know is Rocky W. And they have a resume through the amateurs and the Grand Prix ranks that anyone would love to duplicate. She does a great job. She has super horse IQ. And it's good to see her. I'm sure she's been out here on the West Coast longer than I'm aware, but it's great to see her out here riding. That's a following arm. You see oscillation through the elbow. She's not forcing it, she's following it through the motion of the horse's canter.
Oops. Looks like they had a little miscommunication there. Sometimes that can happen though, you know. You think the horse is with you, and at that last moment, you realize he's not quite there. But that's the...
And a smart change of plans, I'm sure, to go to the low side of jump number three after having a rail at jump number two.
Yeah, and after they had that little gap in communication, she's probably going to spend the rest of this round really, really, really trying to build this horse, his confidence, and also her relationship with it.
There's a second rail cutting down early.
We don't know at this point how much experience this horse has had in a field like this.
She'll get the mileage.
Yep. Absolutely.
I don't think I've ever seen Caitlin tip her hat in the Grand Prix ring. I'm certain she's giving this horse as much mileage as she can on this grass field for the next time.
Well, and though you may have a young horse with a spectacular jump, it takes a while to build this. It's not something that, there's not an overnight sensation. Just that whole partnership, the horses getting the education, understanding the job, understanding the jumps, it's all part of it. And of course, it's an unspoken communication between horse and rider. It's all about feel. And sometimes it just takes time to get in tune with one another.
Good mover.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful across the ground.
So for any of our viewers watching, this was the round that she was not hoping to have today. She was hoping for a better round, but she really gave a great example of how to give a horse confidence and finish on a good note and be better for the next time she enters on the grass or any other International Hunter Derby.
Yeah, and he really finished way stronger than where he started. So he got some value out of today.
Well, position one is a 41. There were two high options. Position two, a 45. That's a 90 total.
Sure, handsome horse.
Mm-hmm.
He'll get this.
Yeah, and the scores reflect the rail, a couple of rails. The judge panel number one took it a little lower than a 45 for the second rail. Panel number two, 45 out of the handy round, but ready to compete the next time there's a class on the grass.
And here comes the first of four. Here's Mr. Nick Hannes.
We have
back with his next ride in the
Nick Hannes back aboard Starburst. Starburst is owned by Ecole Lathrop. Archibald Cox is his trainer. Interesting little tidbit about this horse. Actually, Lauren Huff, one of our Olympians, found this horse in Europe and called Archie and said, this horse needs to be a hunter. And so far, he seems to be developing into a good one.
This is Starbird.
Nick has taken a minute a little further down the field than we've seen some riders, and he made sure he went by the roll top. Jump number four is a solid roll top. It's a good 3 foot three roll top. And he made a good pass by that. So he gave his horse a minute in the ring. And let's watch Nick ride this good horse around. And
Nick has a great sense when it comes to horses and animals in general. He lives with his partner, Ryan, on a farm in Temecula with every exotic species you could want, training zebras, horses, and the like. But he's great at understanding what makes horses tick. Understanding what this horse might take a look at in this ring.
After the lead change, he had to reestablish his pace. Real good job to the swoop. It's a beautiful type. Marked cute, has a cute face. Couple of white little feet. It's really a class act. Balance the 10.
Yeah, did that well.
And so what we were seeing there as he was finishing on strides 8, 9, and 10. He just made sure the horse didn't get there too early and also loosened the arm for a great jump. And horse had a little funny jump. He jumped well. It was a little different than I don't know that he understood that jump like he has the other verticals on the Oxers. I really like this horse.
I do too. He's just looks confident.
Well, he's figuring it out.
Yeah.
You can see his little brain work.
Yeah. But has no qualms about his ability to jump. He's very comfortable with that.
Nick is doing a super job through his position, leg, seat, and hand. to guide this horse straight, keep the rhythm and the style. There's the gallop. That's a good round.
That was quite a good round, yes.
That'll be competitive. That's a good round. Left leg working. Great jump. A little lower hand as he got to the block.
It was really a good jump.
Yeah.
I love his knees nearly hit his chin there.
He's just figuring it all out.
So we're down to three.
Must have had a rail.
Oh, must have had a rail. I didn't see it either. Okay. Bummer.
Cut off for the return.
And here we have Ariel Marks back, this time on Japur, a young Dutch gelding. He's actually new to the first years and just seven. Ariel's got two horses making their International Derby debut today, this being the second one. So we'll see how this youngster handles this course.
Well, we already know Ariel can ride. I mentioned earlier on the other horse that I was hoping that she'd sink in. That was a little shorter backed horse, a little more compact type. This one's a little larger. And Ariel, my impression is that Ariel is not tall.
No, she's not very tall.
So she's going to have to use her position correctly to get every ounce of support that she can riding these first time Derby horses around the field.
Nice pace to the first jump. She's sitting a little deeper on this one.
Somebody listen to the video.
Again, the lower option. But again, this is a very young 7-year-old first-year horse. So she's probably most interested in giving him a really good experience today out on the field.
Well, the option jumps were created to make sure that all levels of horses could participate in the Derbies comfortably, and it's a strategy. We see the strategy in the handy often, where a turn off the high option can be riskier than taking the low option, or a high option jump put in a place that maybe isn't the easiest track point to be able to keep the gallop or the handiness.
Exactly. It was interesting how this horse, he took a look in question for just a second, those swooped rails, but she kept him right there and he jumped out of stride beautifully. Looks like our live feed is just acting up a titch.
It's actually a great opportunity to watch in slow motion.
Yep.
The rider's position and the ability to support the horse through their arms. Independent hands and arms are elastic. That was a good ride. And this is a bigger type of horse. Riders, you know, of all different sizes of conformation ride all different sizes of horses. And knowing what a horse needs to be able to ride smoothly and gallop smoothly across the ground comes from the rider's position. That's how we communicate with the horse, through our instincts, through our feel, through our aids, our natural aids, our legs, weight, voice, hands, and then our artificial aids, or spur, stick. From what I could see from the live stream, it looked like she had a nice round. She got this nice green horse around on her first Derby round pretty nicely.
Yeah, she sure did. She looked pretty confident.
And I very much appreciated that she was giving him a little more support, which it looked like he needed, so I was glad she was there.
Yeah, it was interesting to watch how he just carefully sized up those sweeping rails. That wouldn't have been a good place to lose the support of the rider, which she did very well.
That's a very respectable score, 79 from panel one, a 76 from panel two. She took the lower options, which was exactly the plan, and she had a really positive first round, first Derby on this horse.
Cut off holding at 167.5.
Smart people. Training this horse up for another day to be more competitive.
For final ride.
I think we're getting down to the bottom of the order.
Close.
I think this one and one more for our viewers.
This is Picnic.
Yeah, we have Jenny coming back on her third ride of the day. This is a horse called Picnic.
By Lisa Henkin, Los Angeles.
Picnic has kind of an interesting history in the
high-performance confirmation.
Coming to the International Hunter Derbies. I was told that after this horse decided that he could comfortably canter out of his 4'10" paddock and trot calmly back to the barn, that they decided that the International Hunter Derbies would certainly be in his future. So we'll see today if he has that same cockiness on course. Sure looks like a sweetheart.
The first of just a couple left.
Most good horses have character.
Yeah, I think most of the really good ones come with a cute story or two.
This is an adorable looking horse.
Mm-hmm, he is, and looks very comfortable in his own skin. Picnic is owned, by the way, by Lisa Henkin. Lisa has been a longtime supporter of the Hunters, has had some great Hunters with Jenny over the years.
We saw this horse get just a little uncomfortable with his takeoff at jump number two and just had a hard rub and had the rail and then really jumped up over three. I like the response of the horse to the rub. Got really sharp with his style.
You know, Jenny's one of those thoughtful riders that would think to reach up and stroke the neck after such a big effort.
Now watch her position. She's going to sink in by the in gate. Horses always think about slowing down by an in gate. If you're training your Hunter, you're training your equitation horse or your jumper, ride by the end gate. Don't always pull up at the end gate because it'll come to be something that, you know, you end up having to make an adjustment on a Hunter course because the horse is thinking about pulling up. Ride by your end gates. Just like you saw Jenny do.
Yeah, that's a really good example of not letting your mind get too far ahead to the next jump and make sure that your partner is with you all the way past that gate. Because that can certainly catch riders unaware if you're not tuned in.
That's the horse IQ. What are horses thinking? And so many of the riders in our handy round today have super horse IQ. And these classes bring that up to the mark. Beginners don't really know what's happening. Intermediate fix it after the fact, and advanced never let it happen. We're watching advanced riders give horses balance and impulsion and support through their contact so that they can have beautiful jumps with maximum athletic efforts. Gotta change his lead. There we go.
It was nice to see how patiently Jenny waited until that horse was in a position to be able to give her the lead change. And that's an important feature too. A lot of times riders just ask prematurely for the for the change before the horse is in a position to give it to you. It's unfortunate this horse had a rail at the second jump. Otherwise, very lovely trip. 99.5 total.
Yeah, the balance of the horse really becomes quite the conversation in advanced equitation and derbies. 99.5 overall, the rail reflected in both panel scores.
Qualifying two for the handy here.
I think we have one more, don't we?
We do. Small Kingdom is yet to come. The last ride of Augustus.
Here's another Derby specialist that's going to wrap us up. The young junior.
And
is going to wrap things up with
Small Kingdom.
Score 987.
Has had numerous placings in the International 100 Derbies all over the country, really. Ocala, Tryon, Equifest, Desert
Winner of the.
He's done quite a bit, this guy. And another one that Augustus knows quite well. And along with
she's won several
what a great rider she is, it just adds to the whole thing. Know your horse. It makes the job much easier. You just sort of start to tune in to how other things.
Horses are clairvoyant. Last to go. They know they can read riders' minds, and when the rider and the horse are thinking in one, it shows in the rhythm and the straightness and the athletic ability at that jump, and the scores reflect that as well.
Little bit of a swap there.
Hard rub out of that line. My impression of this is that it's just a little rapid. I'd like to see the long stride that she's working on, and I'd like to see the power, but I'd like to see it just a little more in rhythm.
Thing about this guy, though, he's a little guy, and he really does have to carry more than a lot of the bigger ones.
There he took a breath.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really been the place on course where if horses have been holding their breath a little bit, we see him take a breath at fence seven.
That realization that they will survive.
That got deep. So the distance I saw at fence eight reflected a little bit on the rhythm around the turn, what I was talking about. Just a little extra energy than Super Horse, love the match. Just reflecting on the different rhythms. This is a beautiful jump. We watched a few rounds where the horse jumped every jump exactly the same. There were two walkers where one was jumped a little higher than the other.
Yeah, this one did have a little variation in style along the way.
Not a big deal, just a conversation for our viewers.
Exactly.
With the amount of power these horses have to carry on these big fields, I always like oxer-oxer combinations. It helps the horses. Let's see what our judges think. And this is our last one in the first round, isn't it?
That's our last one in the first round.
All right, so after this, we'll get her scores. Then we'll kick this back in a minute to Jeff Gilbert after we get our scores here. And then they have the Artie Hawkins, which our International Hunter Derby is in honor of today, the Artie Hawkins Award for 2021. That's an exciting award for someone to receive. I can't wait to see who it is.
Scores for our last rider,
85.75.
So an 85 from panel one, an 82 from panel two, ranked eighth overall with a 176.25. So we've concluded the first round of the International Hunter Derby here at Blenheim on the beautiful grass field. And right now we'll give it back to Jeff Gilbert for the Artie Hawkins Award. 15-minute break, and then back for the top 12 for the handy. Don't miss it.
Awards official in the first round here in just a moment.
Man, I got these for you. I think they would look nice in your van. Yeah.
I knew you loved me.
From my heart, bro. These are the freshest flowers in all of San Clemente.
I can tell, man.
We ended up with a cutoff of 170. That's the comeback. We're going to have those results now. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about our top 12 qualifiers and what was a fantastic first round in the $15,000 USHJA International Hunter Derby. In fact, the first round scores for the first one are about the best I've seen anywhere. Winning our first round here, it was Big Shot. Big Shot with big scores of 98 and 94 to lead our first round. That was Jenny Karasisis and Big Shot, winners in the first round. Shout out to the owner, Dulce Lou Morris, there. Now, Jenny qualified two in the top 12, but this young junior rider, she qualified four, and ending up with our second highest score, it was Augusta Iwasaki and Small Social, 985. Augusta Iwasaki riding there for Iwasaki and Riley, Calabasas, California, with a 182. So that was her first one she qualified. Let's go to the third award winner. And this gentleman, he qualified too in the class, Mr. Sean Cassidy. He was awesome in this first round. He was third with 792. That was Casario 8, Sean Cassidy riding for the Ashland Farm. Fourth then, it was Mr. Nick Hannes. And he qualifies fourth here on 1092. That's Caldiano. Nick Hannes rides for the Double Down Farm. And he will double down when it comes to the handy, I'll guarantee that. Nick Hannes ends up fourth. The fifth goes to Rolo. That was the next qualifier of Augusta Iwasaki's. Rolo, number 980, was fifth. Augusta riding for Araya Nathu. Then sixth went to Caraggio. The young professional Emma Lindstrom turns in a beautiful ride here. To end up sixth on Caraggio, 1189, owned by June Salen. Seventh then to another junior rider in the same barn with young Augusta Iwasaki. It's Gabriella Sokolov, who was awesome in her first round, number 978. Gabriella Sokolov and Incandescent qualifying. Congratulations there. Then the eighth award went to Small Kingdom. That was the third qualifier for Augusta Iwasaki, number 987. Also owned by Iwasaki and Riley, Small Kingdom ends up eighth. Ninth in the first round, it's Get Rowdy. Great rider, Jamie Saylor, 417. Who is one of our country leaders here in the derbies, Jamie Saylor, riding for the Teton Farm here. In the ninth position is going to be dangerous. Then we'll go to the 10th place. That was 10-10 silent majority, that great rider Sean Cassidy with his second qualifier. Silent majority ended up 10th. Our 11th qualifier was the Derby Queen, Jenny Karasisis, and her ride on 1362 Cartier du Roé. Jenny rides there for Heidi Kane and qualifies two. And at the cutoff, it was Augusta Iwasaki with her unprecedented 4th out of 12 qualifier in the $15,000 class. She qualified a Tendu du Lenoisy, number 986, at the cutoff of 170. A Tendu de Lenoisy, Augusta Iwasaki, riding there for the Ashland Farm. Man, it's going to be some kind of fantastic handy when we get there. But, you know, we've got some very important award to present now. And ladies and gentlemen, it's a great tradition here to present the Arthur Hawkins Award of Excellence. And I'm very proud to turn you over here to Mr. Vic Carman for that presentation.
Well, thank you, Jeff. The Arthur Hawkins Award of Excellence is given annually to an individual who's contributed to the industry of show hunters in a significant way. This award was established by Blenheim Equisports to honor the commitment and contribution of Arthur to the show hunter industry in general and to the West Coast in particular. Jeff already mentioned that Jenny Karasisis was a winner in past years. Well, not only was she a winner, she was the inaugural winner. It most recently was awarded to Jamie Andrew in 2019, and of course we did not have a horse show last year. We have a recipient for you. Ladies and gentlemen, Gail Ellis has had a lot of success in the horse world, whether she was in the irons herself or owning champion horses proudly from the sidelines. In Chicago is where she began, but her legendary career has led her to many successful years here in California. And for Gail, it all started in 1978 when she and her husband at the time and father of her four children, Tim Sullivan, piqued her interest in a horse. That horse was the legendary thoroughbred Touch the Sun. Touch the Sun showed at their farm with a load of school horses for the Sullivans to try. According to an article in the Practical Horseman, within 20 minutes of watching him go around the ring, they wrote the check. Gail was quick to note that his stride was enormous and made him appear much longer than his 15-3 hands. Now, in his first year as a show horse, Touch the Sun won 78 classes in the row under the guidance of Steve Stevens. Now, think about that. Now, these notes were given to me. The research was done. I read this. 78 classes in a row. That's unbelievable. Rodney Jenkins also rode the horse to numerous year-end titles and an induction to the Show Hunter Hall of Fame. Now, Touch the Sun was not the only horse of Gale's to be inducted in the National Show Horse Hunter Hall of Fame. Isle of Arran was another that Gale proudly owned and also received this prestigious honor. As a rider, Gail also earned many accolades and championships, proving that she was also good at picking horses and recognizing their talent as well as riding them. With Saphir, Gail was crowned the Grand Amateur Owner Champion during the Menlo Horse Show in 2017. Sherry Rose, her trainer, commented, "Horses love Gail. She knows where she is, and the horses just love doing their job and jumping their best for her. It's a real treat to watch." Now, these days, Gail takes much pride and honor in owning, supporting, and producing many top-level hunters to national USEF Horse of the Year Championship. To name a few, listen to this. Saphir, crowned Horse of the Year 6 times. Cortese, Fan Club, Game Day, Reese's, Kamano, Executive, Cassini, Ivory Coast, Why Wonder Why, Neander, Dealmaker, Seacoast Sea, and As Requested. Wow. Now, Nick Hannes has been riding horses for Gail and West Coast Equine Partners for over 8 years. He said, "Riding for Gail is a major honor and privilege. She has had so many incredible horses over the years, and still to this day, she continues to make history in our sport." Well, congratulations, Gail Ellis. Gail, all of the incredible years you've been involved as an owner and rider, all of the incredible horses you've promoted and continued to champion, you will be forever imprinted on our sport. Gail Ellis, you have made West Coast proud, and I hope that you right now. Behalf of Blenheim Sports.
What a great recipient this year, Vic. What a grand lady, Ms. Ellis.
She joins people like I said, Jenny, Archie Cox, John Bragg, John French, Hope Glenn, Carlton Brooks, Peter Lombardo, Nick Hannes, Philip Sillis, Laura Wasserman, Coastie, Janie Andrew, the best of the best.
Yes, and I want to recognize the great Sherry Rose, her trainer there, who I've known for many years, who's done such an excellent job with Ms. Ellis's horses. And of course, the great Nick Hannes, Sherry Rose and Nick Hannes there. With our winner.
Gail, congratulations. I'm going to jump in here and take a moment to thank some of the people who support the Derby program on the national level. I know Joe's getting that second round organized down there. We're looking forward to seeing the top 12 back. And Jeff will be back to kind of talk a little bit more about those in just a moment. But Parlante is the official riding boot of USHJA. A glove-fit, ready-to-wear boot with buffalo inner calf for optimum grip. Long life, unheard of comfort, and unmatched feel. Contact your Parlante stylist today to pick up the official riding boot of the USHJA. Professional's Choice is the official horse boot of USHJA as well. Train and compete like a pro with Professional's Choice Pro Performance Boots. Made with the same technology utilized in NFL football helmets, these boots provide maximum impact protection with every jump. The more comfortable the horse, the better the performance. View the entire Pro Performance line at your local dealer at www.prochoice.com. And CWD Cellier is the official saddle of USHJA. Our thanks to CWD for being that. They have supported this organization as a sponsor since 2016. Remember, I told you they are very strong in support. CWD is a sports saddle maker, primarily known for innovation for the welfare of horses and performance of riders. 10 years ago, the company spent more than $2 million to develop a dynamic tree that aims to provide the perfect mix of flex and pressure distribution for the horse's comfort. And since then, the company has launched the Mademoiselle saddle, the first hunter jumper saddle developed specifically for the female rider. CWD's commitment to high quality leather and a vegetable tanning process sets their saddles apart in longevity.
Just a minute away here. Let's recap and look at our top competitors here in the second round. Of course, Big Shot and Jenny Karasisis are going to be the last to go, and they had the big shot with the 98 and the 94. But then it's Small Social and Augusta Iwasaki who sits second. So again, the score to beat there 192 for Big Shot. Then Gussie had in 182 for a Small Social. A little bit of a hill to climb there between those two, but it should be okay with that extra added handy bonus score in the second round. Then it's Casario 8 sitting third with Sean Cassidy. They're number 179. Then it's Caldinos and Nick Hanna sitting for the 178. A handy round coming up. I love the line in the specifications. I always like to repeat if I have a chance. It says that riders should be rewarded for making daring choices, difficult turns, working with brilliance and pace. As we'll add that to the scoring here. Second round score, the higher options, and then the handy score to be adding. The three scores will be announced separately, then added together to determine the winner here, the handy round. Might have...
to the International Hunter Derby here at Blenheim Equisports. We have our first handy horse on course. We'll go over the round with you. Number 986, the first jump is an imposing jump. It's the jump number 3 from the first round, and they really gallop at that right out of the end gate. The left rollback turn to the vertical and another long gallop.
Yeah, kind of one end of the ring to the other.
This is a little bit of a different test than what we saw in the first round. Now the horses are galloping. They don't really know where they're going. The riders have to put their eye on that roll top without very wide standards. That was jump selection by the course designer and a rider test, which she passed beautifully. Then the inside turn back to the in and out. All the way to the other end of the field. Now here the horse is thinking, where is he going? She has to keep him on his lead. They're diagonal aids, left leg, right rein. Beautifully done.
This is, by the way, a Tendu de Lenoir, ridden by Augusta Iwasaki. I was asked by someone if I could mention the breeds of these horses, and this is actually a Saint Francais.
The roll top has been removed. These are two unrelated jumps. They are a long way away. And the rider's job will be to make sure the horse is focused at the last jump and gets across the back rail. Augusta came back with a score of 172. We have handy points in play. We have high bonus points in play. And the horse's rhythm, straightness, and style. Green incentive state there. And we'll wait for the scores. Our first competitor, he had to slow down a little to fit that distance in, and he just had the front rub on the back rail.
Now we wait to see what they do with the scores. Each panel can give bonus points, so that definitely will influence the scores.
Yeah, there's 18 points in play.
Right.
28 points in play. 10 from each judge for the handy. That's 20 plus 4, and that's 28 points in play from each panel, besides the rhythm and straightness and quality of the horse.
And our first scores are in now for our handy round. Entry number.
An overall score of 346. In this round, we had an 80 and a 76.
Number one.
for a total of 176, and the scores are added, and that's where you get the total of 346. Let's just say thank you to the critical people that make the live stream happen and all of the opportunities here at Blenheim Equisports. David Portner is chairman of marketing, head of marketing at Blenheim Equisports. We very much thank Robert Ridland, who's president of the Equisports Group here at Blenheim. Stephanie Lightner, who's in charge of VP of Operations. Alex Zulia, who's in charge of special programming. Penny Carpenter and Debbie Sands are our stewards here this week. We thank you very much. All the ladies in the horse show office, thank you. We can't get along without you. Thank you so much for what you're doing to make sure it goes smoothly during the COVID protocols. You all are doing a great job.
Now, here we have Jenny on her first one back, Cartier de Rouet. This is a Westphalian gelding. Oh, I'm sorry, I jumped the gun. It's Silent Majority. Silent Majority, ridden by Sean Cassidy. And this is a Hanoverian gelding.
Great gallop to one. The rider's contact and confidence is key to the first fence. Keeping the power up at two.
That was a nice turn back.
They totaled 171 in their first round.
Keeping a pretty good gallop down to the other end of the field. The horses are definitely a little more comfortable with that log the second time around.
The trot jump is first a downward transition forward and then settling for the rhythm of the trot. After a trot jump, riders have to increase their impulsion because you land without the horse going forward to the in and out question. So you have a couple of factors working there. You have the lack of impulsion landing off the trot jump, plus you have the short turn that diminishes impulsion. That's a real good riding question.
Looks like he maybe did a little swap there. Sometimes it's harder to hold that lead in the handy when you are in fact anticipating a turn. Nice gallop to the last there.
Good job. That horse to me, Sean, needed to keep a little more contact than he did in the first round. The horse was a little up. Not as sure as where he was going as he was in the more classic hunter round. Great ride. Cute horse. Again, just has to get very, very comfortable on the gallop. Stabilizing a horse at that higher rate of speed takes a little bit of experience.
Arrived to the 171 from round one, position one has 80.
They liked it. It was a good round. 84 from both panels. 8 and 7 handy points for a total of 362. The handy points reflect the gallop and the turns. We have a few handy masters in this class.
Yes.
I think we'll see. I'm guessing on one of Nick's horses, I don't know how many he has in, but I'm guessing both Nick and Jenny will both pull out all the stops.
Now here, next in our handy, number 1362 is organized to go. This is Cartier.
Now we have Cartier Gateway with Jenny Karasisas. This horse comes back with a 171. He is a Westphalian gelding. Du Roy
is an entry owned by Heidi Kane. First, get the lead. Then establish some pace.
Because you'll notice in the handy round, the riders go directly to the first jump.
First the pace, now the line. Now the distance. Textbook.
Landing a little bit of a crossfire there for a stride or two.
So the question at the first jump is, do you have enough pace? And for me, this horse was underpaced to the first jump, and his arc showed you that a little bit with the way that he sort of landed in not going as forward as he has over the other defenses.
Well, and I think that that presents a pretty imposing first jump. So going straight away from the in gate, it is of utmost importance that you get a fair amount of pace.
That was really well done. That horse had a lot of question about the trot jump, and she just legged him quietly and got the rhythm handled beautifully. Something more aggressive there might have had a much different result. That was beautifully ridden and a great example of feel.
Yeah, I think really patience to the trot jump is the key. He really jumped that.
This horse is a little tighter through his back for me this round. He jumped really loose in the first round, and he's just a little tighter in this round.
It's almost like he left the ring, thought about it, and came back a little bit more impressed than he was in the first round. There, as you can see, where he landed on that crossfire, meaning the different lead in the front and the back after that jump. Here you can see Jenny wait so patiently to the base of that jump.
Now we'll get the scores. We have Sean Cassidy at the moment on top. We've seen two. This will be the third one we've seen in the handy. We have 12 or 13 coming back. Did we have a tie?
12.
12 coming back.
Yeah, they ended up with 12.
Our scores are with 171 in the first round.
Oh, we've sure enjoyed everyone watching here on the live stream. We appreciate them making that available. There we have the handy points of 6 and 8. The first panel number 1 is 75, panel number 2 is 78, for a total of 346, ranking second. So we see the reflective jumping style in the scores, but great opportunity with the high bonus points in the handy. So good for Jenny, and that horse got a great experience today. We'll see how that shakes out.
Entering the ring now, we have Get Rowdy with Jamie Saylor. Jamie is a longtime competitor in the jumper ring, so she should be particularly one to watch in the handy round. Oh, I beg your pardon. Looks like we've shifted the order a little bit. Let's wait and see. Well, this should be Jamie.
So it's very interesting. You saw this rider come and stand at the in gate for whatever reason. We were not in communication with the gate, but she chose to keep walking afterwards, which is quite important because as you step into the ring, whomever it's going to be, that first 3-4 steps cantering are critical to setting your pace. So you see this rider walking, legging this horse, even doing a little shoulder four as she's walking, keeping the horse's loin warmed up. That's the part of the horse behind the saddle. Not having it be a stiff, cold moment. So when she strikes onto that right lead, the horse is warmed up and moving behind. That's critical, what we just saw there. That was a very good example with this camera angle.
So this is, in fact, Jamie Saylor on Get Rowdy. As I said, she's had lots of experience in the jumper ring, so I would expect this to be a very handy round.
Great gallop.
Really good the first jump. wanted to play a little after that. That never bothers me as a judge. I don't mind enthusiasm from a horse unless they just are being disobedient.
Well, there's a difference between a horse's expression jumping and them having bad manners in a hunter class.
Exactly.
Bucking is bad manners.
Right.
Kicking out, lighten the croup, resistance to the aids, those are all manners.
That was a very nice transition to the trot.
First the lead, then the power, now the line and the distance. Just like that. You want the impression of going forward without rushing, in rhythm. Left leg, right rein. Nice angle on that jump with a lot of pace. Hard to do.
A nice gallop to the end here. That was superbly ridden once again by Jamie Saylor.
Hard rub at the last jump. One panel will be closer to that, the panel on that side of the ring, than the other. This was a really good ride here.
Yeah, she...
Notice her position. Notice how she's with the horse, not ahead of the horse, and supporting every stride, including the stride in the air. She's a good rider. I don't know her well, but I sure respect how she rides.
Jamie's a very upbeat person, reflects in her.
Here we go. 7 and 8 handy points. Panel 1 and 86, panel 2 and 81. I suspect panel 2 is on the closer side to the Oxer where she had the hard rub.
Hard job, yeah.
And an overall 365, taking over the lead from Sean Cassidy in the early going. So that's great.
And there's our new leaders in that. That Jamie Saylor.
The handy points and the ability to work with gallop, the ability to work in rhythm with the rollback turns. I like that Carrie Coker has put a rollback turn to the left and a rollback turn to the right, which is challenging both the horses and the riders being ambidextrous, which is critical. We talked about horses landing on both leads earlier.
Here comes Augusta back on Small Kingdom. This is also a Saint-Francais gelding. Vast experience doing these derbies.
You know, so if you're watching on the live stream, you're going to be asking the question, what does that trip do to her score? Probably nothing. The rider did the exact right thing that when a horse trips, she closed her leg and the rhythm didn't change a beat. If a horse trips and the rhythm changes, that's the issue. And there's a little swap early at that log. So that's created when the rider's diagonal aids are not quite there enough. The angle was quite severe, trying to be very handy. That'll be reflected in her score. Could still be a good round. It'll just be a deduction that's taken. The other aspect of that is that it reflects on the horse's lack of straightness.
Well, I think the key in always in angle jumps is making sure that the horse is dead straight between both hands and both legs on the angle, where when you shift from one hand to the other, it can definitely create that swap.
You know, we saw a little of this with some of the riders putting the distance ahead of the track in some of the equitation finals. And I think it's a key reminder to anybody watching on the live feed. It's pace, line, distance. Can never put the distance ahead of the line.
Or the pace, for that matter.
That's a great example, slow motion watching. That's a beautiful ride with the diagonal aids there.
And beautiful position, hip angle closed, right with the motion, going with the horse rather than hanging back against it.
Waiting on her scores. I think that was her fourth or fifth one, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Fifth horse. Yeah, reflected. Good handy points, 9 mm-hmm. and 6. 76 from one panel and 83 from the other. Mm-hmm. Total of 358.25 and into third at the moment in the early going. Still about halfway through the handy. Just about halfway through.
Okay, 368.25, as you can see. The total for the last one is where?
Next should be one of our junior riders, Gabrielle Sokolov. She's coming back on her horse, Incandescent.
978, Incandescent, is next in the handy. Score 978, Incandescent. This is the
first, the lead.
Gabrielle Sokolov.
Now the pace. Which she's having a little hard time getting going. Really good.
Stayed with him beautifully in the air there. He gave a pretty good effort.
This one brings back a 176.
So it's hard to gallop without knowing where you're going exactly in regards to the distance. That's why you practice that, so that you can pick up a gallop, set that pace, and then be a little bit loose getting into the first jump. That was a really bold ride to that jump.
It sure was.
Did a great job. That pace was a little stronger than what we saw to the first fence.
Another good trot jump. The riders could have the option of going around to that in and out, but so far nobody's chosen to do that.
This is looser now. This isn't a great rhythm after the first fence. This has a great feel to it. Hard rail. Oh,
unfortunately, just had a rail at that one.
Good experience for this rider.
Absolutely.
Cue horse.
Just too bad. It's interesting, though, he kind of pointed out to us, often it is challenging to get a horse to step right away from the in gate and go.
That's the rider question in Terry's, in Carrie's course.
Exactly. Well, and a little bit the horse. I mean, there are some horses that are somewhat reluctant to leave the group. They, of course, are herd animals, so that's the strong draw to the in gate.
We always teach a million steps to the trot jump. Never in a hurry to the trot jump. Yeah, we'll wait for her scores. Panel, they'll reflect the 45 for the rail, but she'll get her handy points and she'll get the high option points. It's really a beautiful day out when we stepped out of the live stream trailer. It was really beautiful. There we go. 5 and 6 handy points, 45 from both panels, a 285 overall, and at the moment ranks 6th.
That young junior rides great, that Gabby Sokolov.
With 6 more to go, maybe 7, 6 or 7. Sue's keeping track, Sue Lightner here, and myself, Diane Carney, happy to do the commentary here at Blenheim Equisports. Grateful to be here judging all week. And
fun to get to watch.
Yeah, it's that's really great fun.
Yeah. Here we have Emma Lindstrom back on Caraggio. Caraggio is a Holsteiner gelding. This horse was quite good in the first round.
Good Good gallop. Now the back rail.
This was the horse that was, oh, so consistent the first round.
So that was,
can happen.
That was interesting for me watching this. That surprised me a little bit, although I'd love to see a replay of that when we get a chance, because it looked like there was a pretty severe angle and he might not have known which one he was supposed to jump.
Oh. Apparently he doesn't want to do the handy round today.
So when a horse makes a mistake like that, she's doing a great job of reaching forward and reaching up and grabbing either the mane or her hand around the neck of the horse. That's the learning curve of a moment like this, which is unfortunate, but to be able to not be against the horse, but to be with the horse in that situation.
Now she chose the low option, which was a good choice under the circumstances. Just now the point is to get this horse in a good mental state, getting around this course without any further issues.
Good strategy to go low.
Yeah, I think now she's just gonna really concentrate on his consistency and keeping his attitude in a good
confidence.
Place.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if we see a replay when this is over. The very first time she approached that first jump, it to me almost looked like he was a little confused as to which one or the angle was too sharp. It's an imposing jump, those swoop boxers. I would imagine the swoop rail oxers and the lob will be making an appearance in most people's training going forward.
Exactly.
Especially if you know they're at Blenheim Equisports and they're pulling them out. Then,
exactly.
Because there's a long summer ahead. Great sport here at Blenheim, both in the Grand Prix ring and the jumpers and the hunters and the equitation.
Well, and of course, for horses that plan on making the trip to Kentucky for the Derby finals, you never know quite what you might see there.
Well, they use the swoop as the trot jump. They use a broken log, tree limb, something. I don't know what it was.
Yeah.
Bobby Murphy and those guys bring out all sorts of things from them. They'd probably be in the burn pile at my farm, and they're coming out to be old rejuvenated fences. So. That's too bad. That was unfortunate. She had a great day in the Derby, and I love what she did with her horse IQ to bring this horse's confidence back. Here we go to the first fence. Let's see exactly where she lined up. Looks to me like he's drifting right. Yeah. You see
yeah,
that?
Could be.
To me, it almost looked like she aimed to the middle.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was just a mistake in lining it up. Because he sure jumped around the rest of the course beautifully.
Yeah.
It's a heck of a good horse. They'll learn from that.
The position thought the same way, 20 plus two high options plus two for the handy. That's 48 in round two and 225.25 overall.
225 overall. Really good job on the rider, on Emma's part, getting that horse around confidently for another day. And she'll learn from that experience, whatever the team, sizes up to be what happened from point. Nice horse, nice match. I look forward to seeing more of them in the future.
And Jamie Saylor, their total 365.5. But it looks like it's time for Nick Handy, as we will go to number 1092.
I think next coming back into the ring is
1092.
Galdiano with Nick Hannes, who's fondly known as Nick Handy.
For the double down farm.
So we'll see just how handy he is.
First the lead. Now you see him setting his pace. He has a great sense of where the jump is, and then he's going to give support to the back rail. Beautiful jump. Now the rhythm is what we watch.
Nice gallop here going down the ring. And then you see him just take a little feel, getting ready to turn to that log.
Little spook.
You could see that, right? And obviously Nick was prepared for that possibility.
Horse propped. He had contact, which is why it didn't turn into anything greener. Nick will continue to put the handy portion of the scoring into his overall score. He'll continue to do as much as he feels confident with this horse to get as much gallop and jump out of him as possible. And the judges will reflect that mistake in their deduction and their score.
Great gallop to the last two and great gallop to this last.
I think he did three less than anybody else.
Probably, yeah.
I think he galloped right on down there.
There's a great example of get the pace and then find the jump.
Yep.
That was beautifully done.
Contact. This is contact. Watch his hands. He'll grip the rein a little tighter without pulling on the elbow. Just like that. And just the grip of the rein as the horse's neck is moving balances the horse in the rhythm. It's not about a big movement in the elbow or the elbow at that moment taking them out. It's just about firming up the feel of the rein. Here the arm is oscillating because he's really got a gallop.
It's interesting too. I love to watch Nick. He always stays with the motion, but never in front of the pommel. He's always right in the center of the horse's balance.
So we'll wait and see the scores. You'll have high handy points, I think, and the high options. Yeah, and the spook was reflected in the judge's scores. He got 8 handy points, which are, I think that 16 is the highest or close to what we've seen. All high options, a total of 355 overall, and currently ranked 4th. Those two will get to know each other, and that little situation off of the right turn will get ironed out. And that was a lovely round, putting that horse together after that.
It's not always a bad thing, even though it's as observant as that last one. Often it reflects their level of intelligence. You have to appreciate a horse that pays attention to where everything is. The key is to give him enough exposure that he gets comfortable with all the different questions.
And at the different rates of speed.
Exactly.
All right.
We have...
Let's introduce
Augusta multiple rides again. Here. She's been very efficient getting herself ready.
Rolo, 980 Rolo brings a 178 from their first round together. 980 Rolo is owned by Orion Nathu.
Augusta. Last thing I would want to do is stand at the end gate and then walk in. I agree with these riders that are making a turn. 5.5. They're needing to wait until they're cued in the ring. So they're following directions.
Well, and particularly when you have to strike a lick and go.
That's
right
the second one of hers that is tripped.
Yeah. Oh.
And that affected.
Whoa.
And that affected the rhythm to the jump.
Oh, I hope she's okay there.
Just stay right there.
So at this time, let's talk a little bit about what a great opportunity it is here at Blenheim and showing out on the grass. The riders all get tremendous experience, and sometimes it's a little bit of the school of hard knocks, but we're very hopeful that everybody is all right. And it is not uncommon to see the best of the best every once in a while have a situation. They make a mistake. It's good to see her up and walking out of the ring, and that's what a horseman does. She ran up stirrups, reins off of the horse's neck and walking out. And I'm sure we'll see her other horses. I think she has at least one more to ride.
Yeah, she has another to go. She has another to go.
But you know, that happens, and in this sport, there's one thing I know from riding is if I'm going to ride a horse, at some point in my life, or multiple times in my life, I'm going to fall off.
Indeed.
We hope that it doesn't happen competitively, but sometimes it does because these riders are trying their hardest. They're trying to get every inch they can gallop. And that's what competition is. And it happens. They're on to the next horse and moving on to the next rider that'll compete, and Augusta will get on her next horse.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's something that comes with the territory to follow. Oftentimes when you start little ones and they're very afraid of falling, and you try to do your best to make sure that doesn't happen for a while, but eventually it's going to happen to all of us. You realize that you can survive and go on to another day, another round.
See Jamie Taylor, sailor, leading with the 365, Sean right behind her with the 362. We have still quite a few left, I think five.
We have three, actually.
Oh, three left,
yeah,
great.
We have the Casario 8 horse, which I think is another of Sean's. And we have another of Augusta's, and then we have Jenny to complete the field on Big Shot. Three difference to go. Probably take a little bit for Augusta to get resituated, but she'll be fine.
So it's an interesting conversation you brought up, starting beginners. And I think sometimes people forget that what makes somebody secure on a horse is that they have a good seat. And we're commenting on the contact of some of these good riders, that they have a great seat. And Sean is a real good example of that.
And here he comes on Casario 8, a Holsteiner gelding, confidently picking up the gallop.
So the rider's ability to connect leg, seat, and hand is key to giving the horse confidence and helping shape a beautiful jump, whether it be in the Hunter Derby or the Grand Prix, for that matter. Watch the connection of the rider's seat to the horse's balance as they sink in right there.
I think, though, as you mentioned once before, the sink is the real important thing. I think that that's important for the horse's balance, but it's so different from sitting down and leaning back.
Oh, for sure.
So different.
Well, the riders have four angles, ankle, knee, hip, elbow, and they all need to stay bent. You don't want to see a straight arm. You don't want to see a straight knee. Certainly don't want to see what you're talking about, the upper body behind the motion. Four angles, ankle, knee, hip, elbow.
Live feet is a little jumpy right there.
Those are great moments of slow opportunity to really look at the position and what's going on stride for stride. Really good.
Yeah, that was a very nice round. Very, very nice.
From what we all could see on the live stream, I think it was a good round.
Yeah.
I know it was a good ride. It gets back to talking about the beginners and getting a seat. So a lot of time in a Western saddle, beginners, so that they really get secure. And then from there, you know, there are some Olympians. Charlie Jane is a really good example, who started that way. And, you know, riding bareback and all the things that we used to do that really give a rider the ability to know where they're at on the back of a horse, which is what you're seeing with Sean Cassidy and so many of the other riders too.
Well, I had to ride bareback early on because I couldn't lift the saddle up.
There you go. That's a way. I'm not so sure that I didn't learn to fall off a tethered horse onto a rubber gymnastics mat the first time, but you know, we were taught all of that. We did a little vaulting and did all of them. Yeah, for sure. I can't wait to see what they want to do with Sean. It was hard for us to see a little bit with the line, but it looked like a real good round. Yeah. Richland Farms, Ken and Emily.
And scores are in, bringing 170 position. One has an 85 raw score. Four high up.
Yeah,
oh, they liked it.
I liked it. I'm right with them. 8 and 7 handy points. The total is 374 overall, 85 and 87 from the judges. I thought it was riding a real, real good jumping horse.
Yeah,
beautifully ridden and jumped beautiful.
He's accurate, and he's got the new high score. But here comes the high score from the first round, ladies and gentlemen. It's time to introduce.
That's exciting. To our high school. And we have three good handy riders left to go.
Two now. We have Augusta and Jenny, and it looks like Jenny's going to move up for Augusta to give her a little bit more time to prepare on her last horse.
That's what sportsmanship looks
absolutely.
Like.
Absolutely. Brings a 192.
Plus, she was getting ready at the same time. She did what was best for a horse and helped out another exhibitor, and that's what being a good sport's all about.
Oh, nice first jump.
Beautiful.
He liked it too.
And for those of you watching on the live stream, that little expression that the horse has with his head and neck is real. That's not trying to buck. That's the horse finishing his jump and knowing that he made a great effort.
Exactly. He thought it was good too.
These horses know they're competing. They know they're in a big event. And horses like Brunello and Big Shot all really make a little extra effort when they're on or the pressure is on.
Big Shot, by the way, for those who had asked, is a Holsteiner. Once again, a Holsteiner with a lot of success with Jenny and the Irons.
Got a little slow turning to the in and out. She wasn't able to quite get the pace I think she wanted. She trusted her horse. Gave her a beautiful jump out and out. For the riders watching, the people watching, and you thought a little slow, I agree with you, but she trusted her horse and got a great jump out of it.
Well, and it felt like Jenny maybe turned just a hair tighter, too, to that, which would contribute to the slightly slower pace. He's going to make up for it here and go gallop. Nice big effort over the last Oxer.
Yeah, it's a quality horse, quality round, minor deductions. I think we'll see a big score. This is contact. This is diagonal aids. This is left leg, you see it working, a little right rein opening, and not so much left rein across the neck as a bearing rein that the horse thought there was a lead change. And let's wait and see these big scores, I hope, for Big Shot. Wouldn't be the first time that Big Shot saw some big scores.
So. Yeah, exactly.
And it probably won't be the last. For me, Big Shot has a little more gallop than the Ashland Farms horse.
Jeff said she rode here with
a little looser jump. They thought so too.
Yep.
An overall 393 with 7 handy points and an 87 from panel 1 and a 92 from panel 2. And both panels reflected the turn to the in and out a little bit in their score, and yet the quality of the horse and the jump that the horse gave her is why those scores are as high as they are. So that's fantastic. You can make those turns and have a quiet moment as long as you trust your horse and know you have the scope to jump out. If Jenny had even thought for a minute that she was getting there long and overridden it would have made it different in the way the horse jumped out of the in and out.
Absolutely.
The trust factor you've been talking about, Sue, which is so key in these matches, is a great example of that situation for Jenny.
Yeah, those two know each other so well. They've been through the highs and the lows together. And for those up and coming in the derbies, Jenny and Big Shot, before all their success, have had some rocky roads, so
we've got one more to go. Small social,
they're for everybody.
We're just waiting on one rider to come back. His team in charge of marketing here, Blenheim Equisports. I so appreciate the live stream when I'm not sitting right here at the horse show and I'm traveling and I tune in. Alex Zulio's in regards to is in charge of special programs. Robert Ridlin, president of operations. Stephanie Lightner, vice president of our operations. We thank our stewards, Debbie Sands and Penny Carpenter, and all the people in the office. Our judges this week, Sue Lightner, who's sitting here with me on the commentary, Sue Ash and Mark Bone, who are judging, and James Waldman, I think it is, James Waldman, and Brian Lenihan judging today, also all this week here at Blenheim Equisports. We'll finish here at the Derby, and all of us will go on to our assignments for the day and be judging until sundown.
Exactly. We have Sharon Stewart out there probably in the schooling area, making sure that everybody abides by the rules.
And we have Janet. We can't forget Janet.
Oh, our technical coordinator extraordinaire, that would be Janet.
Who makes sure we're all following the COVID protocols.
Exactly.
And we all get our text messages and the great people that make sure the judges are all taken care of, the nice lady that does lunch, and the great in-gate guys. They do a super job, guys and gals.
You got Meredith Mateo running around picking up all the judges' sheets.
Yeah, it's fantastic. The great team here at Blenheim Equisports. They've been doing it a while, and they get it right. We really appreciate it as judges and exhibitors. So this is where we stand at the moment with one left to come back. Quite a lead Jenny has over Sean. I don't know whether the last horse can make it up or not, but we'll see. And that's what great competition's all about. It's been a wonderful class.
Yeah, it sure has. Very strong class, I thought.
I think Carrie Coker's course has been super. Comes from a long line of horsemen. Here we see Augusta getting dusted. Dust, getting the dust off from the schooling area and getting the final preparations. And this young lady is a tough competitor.
She sure is.
She will come back from the two rounds that she has had, and she will try and lay it down on this horse just as if nothing has gone on. So she's going to have a great opportunity here to show the people on the live stream what it's like to come back from a little bit of a school of hard knocks and lay it down.
You watch this young lady compete and you realize she's just 16 and maybe just get a driver's license. She's a whiz at all these big classes.
She brings a 182 total back to the competition.
She's going to get the back rail and then leg.
This is small social, Augusta Iwasaki.
Just like that. Beautiful.
This is a scopey horse. Remember, this is the one that used to be a jumper of Will Simpson, so you know it has some scope.
I particularly like what she did coming in to the first fence on this horse. She took her time and made sure she had a good balanced horse with a good gallop, which gave her a beautiful first jump. And that showed me that this young lady is a student, because she had two horses that were a little out of balance when she started the other early rounds. This one she did a little sharper and had a better result. And
beautiful trot.
That shows great, great learning for this young lady.
Small social, for those who ask, is an Oldenburg. Very handsome Oldenburg. Gust is keeping up her pace. I mean, she rides as though she never had that mishap on the last horse, but that's a real little professional.
That lead change is going to be reflected in the fact that the horse didn't stay straight. That'll be reflected in her score, hard rub at the last jump. I thought she did an excellent job and has given this horse a very competitive ride, and we'll wait and see what the judges do with it. But kudos to her. My hat goes off to Augusta coming in as she rode to the first jump the way she did right here.
Mm-hmm. However this goes, you've got to give credit to that young Augusta Iwasaki coming back.
Great slow motion shot.
Yeah, really beautiful.
Real good job. Well, we sure appreciate you all being on the live stream with us. I'm Diane Carney, sitting here with Sue Lightner. Thanks for tuning in. And I think at this point in time, we'll be kicking it back to the horse show announcer, Jeff Gilbert.
Yes.
Have a good day, everybody.
Well, Jeff, here's our final scores of the great class. Arriving here with the 182, there was from position one, 86.5, four high options and eight for the handy. position 288 for high options, 7 for the handy. That's a 197 in the second round and 379.5 overall.
Fantastic. Have the second round results here in just a moment, and then go to the overall. Stand by. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to share with you the results of the second round. Here, the handy round. The best in the handy? Of course, 976 Big Shot and Jenny Karasisis, who had two great rides, and she was spectacular in the handy. Note those seven numbers in the handy to add to those 87 and 92 base scores. It's awesome to win. He's the second in the handy phase. You just saw her. That was Augusta Iwasaki, Small Social. They were great as well. She had handies from the two panels, Small Social. Augusta Iwasaki, just incredible. To the gentleman, Sean Cassidy, with a beautiful ride on Casarino 8 in the handy. Sean was third in the handy here, 92. And entered by the Ashland Farm. The fourth went to 10-10. 10-10 in the handy was Silent Majority. Sean Cassidy. So he's back to back here with two great rides. And again, as a sailor, with a great trip, 190 total. She had 7/8 in the handy portion. Today's handy, 987 with Small Kingdom. The seventh went to 10/92. De Lenoisie with Augusta Iwasaki for the Ashland Farm. The ninth went to 13/62. It was Cartier du Rouet and Jenny Karasisis for Heidi Kane. 10th in the handy portion, 9/78 then. That was Incandescent and Gabrielle Sokolov. And the 11th to 11/89. 11/89 was Coraggio, Emma Lindstrom.
We'd like to thank some of the partners who help us so much. The high score amateur in our event will receive an award from the Plaid Horse. They're America's premier horse show magazine. Don't miss an issue.
pick up yours in the horse show office or at the Lookout Point Lodge in the VIP tent as well. The winning rider awards also Shady Lady Sun Protection. Those scarves are lightweight, breathable face coverings made with a top-line sun fabric, and it's a natural UP50+. Our thanks also to Top Line Design Ribbon Wreaths. They specialize in making wreaths and other works of art from your hard-won ribbons. They excel in incorporating photos, logos, custom colors, as well as providing art, gift ideas, and horse show prizes. Jeff, these are the people that are with us not only nationally, but also individually here all through the week, and very much involved in the presentations of our Derby Awards.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've got a couple special announcements, special presentations we want to make here before we get to the results of the top 12. The Plat Horse presents the High Score Amateur Rider Award, and that's where we're going right now, as we want to congratulate amateur rider Alexis Meadows, number 649 and Verdict. They're our highest scoring overall amateur rider. They'll receive the Plat Horse branded saddle pad and ribbon. Congratulations there to Alexis Meadows and Verda coming in. There she is, Alex Zulia making the presentation. High-scoring amateur, Alexis Meadows. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me congratulate our high score junior. Again, as I mentioned, maybe one of the best junior riders in the entire world, and that would be Augusta Iwasaki. She proved it today too, didn't she? Coming back after a fall to have a fantastic handy trip and end up second overall in today's competition. That's young Augusta Iwasaki, riding small social, showing as a 16-year-old, riding for Iwasaki and Riley, the young phenom, Augusta Iwasaki. We're gonna go to our top 12 now. We'll start here on the end of the line. We're so pleased also to have Merrick Mateo with us in the presentation, and Cheryl Wheaton in the ring here. Two hard-working, great people. Let's start with the 12th award winner, ladies and gentlemen, and that is 980. That is Rolo. That was one of the qualifiers for Augusta Iwasaki. Rolo, number 980. Araya Nathu, the older there. The 11th went to Caraggio. Emma Lindstrom, who was great in the first round, a little trouble in the second round. I think that's a green horse. Caraggio, Emma Lindstrom ended up 11th here, 11.89, and her ride was for June Salad. Let's talk about our 10th, because she's not here. It was Gabby Sogoloff and Incandescent. She couldn't make it. She had a conflict. That was 10th. So here's ninth right here. That's Cartier du Rouet. And Jenny Karacisis did the riding on this one, 1362. Cartier du Rouet was an entry owned by Heidi Kane, great amateur rider. Train. Let's go to eighth now. Let's go to Attendu de Lenoir Z. That was the other ride here for Augusta Iwasaki, number 986. That owner is the Ashland Farm, Augusta Iwasaki for Attendu de Lenoir Z, number 986. Let's go to seventh. Mr. Nick Hannes here, 1092 is seven, riding for the Double Down Farm on Caldiano. The sixth went to Small Kingdom. That was another ride for the junior Augusta Iwasaki, number 987, owned by Iwasaki and Riley. Let's go to fifth in Silent Majority. And the gentleman, Sean Cassidy, who ends up fifth overall on Silent Majority, riding there for the Meadow Farm. Great rider. Let's go to the fourth. It's Get Rowdy. Jamie Saylor was solid today with two fine efforts here, riding Get Rowdy for the Teton Farm. Third in the contest, Casario 8. That's Sean Cassidy again. That gentleman went third and fourth, third and fifth in the $15,000 class with a fantastic ride on Casarino 8, posting huge scores here to be in the third spot. 792 is owned by the Ashland Farm. Let's go to the reserve in the contest and congratulate again young Augusta Iwasaki and Small Social, coming back to end up reserve in the $15,000 class after a terrible fall. She's reserved with Small Social, an entry owned by Iwasaki and Riley. And now let's go to the big shot and congratulate our winner with actually two knockout punches. She was unbeatable. She had scores basically of 98 and 94 in the first round for a 192, and she was even better in the handy with scores of 98 and 92 with sevens in her handy scores, a 201 total for her handy round, and to win with a 393, which is an absolute huge score in a derby like this. We congratulate Jenny Karacisis on Big Shot. Dulce Lou Morris from Malibu, California is our winning owner and our USHJ sponsoring the Coolerette and the Halter. Shady Lady, the face and neck scarf. Top line design ribbons and wreaths. The gift certificate there, the embroidered tack room pillow presented by Nick Biasi, Equestrian Design Group. Turning on a world-class performance here, Big Shot. It was a magnificent performance, ladies and gentlemen. Absolutely the best in the West. It's Big Shot and Jenny Karacisis with another big win in the Derby. She won the 50 and the 100 in the desert. And here at Blenheim, she wins our International Hunter Derby here. Congratulations again to Dulce Lou Morris of Malibu, the owner. Then the young phenom Augusta Iwasaki was second with Small Social. She had three in the ribbons. Fantastic rider Sean Cassidy was third with Casarino 8, and then he was fifth with Silent Majority. That's Get Rowdy and Jamie Saylor, who ended up fourth in the contest. Calianos and Nick Hannes, who were seventh. Cartier du Murray and Jenny Kersey's his other ride, ninth. Then it's Caraggio and Emma Lindstrom and Roller. Wow, was that a good class? Doesn't get any better than that, ladies and gentlemen. So go on and have a great rest of the day here as we'll turn this back into a jumper ring. So see you over at the Hunter Rings. Want to thank Big Carmen again and our great judges, Panel 1, Sue Ash and Mark Bone, Panel 2, Brian Lanahan and James Waldman. That fantastic course designer, Kerry Coker. And we'll see you.
And that's all for today. We hope you've enjoyed today's show, and you can join us for our next featured class, which is going to be the $75,000 Interactive Mortgage Ticket to Ride High Performance Jumper Series Grand Prix, coming to you this Sunday. We hope you can join us.